On your radio again comes the strains of Cuddly Ken.
Hello there.
And now for a word from our sponsor.
But now to take us to the shipping forecast, we're sailing by.
Hey, ding, ding. There's a seagull on the transmitter.
Well, have you? Could you? It can be done, for here's proof before your eyes. It's Jeffrey's Flea Circus at Birmingham, and nothing's too difficult for the performers.
Now the shipping forecast on behalf of the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency.
Only the lonely.
Hello, I'm Johnny Diamond, and welcome to the world this week.
We need all the protection that we can get.
There's a small business, and they appear to be making money. Don't they know there's a pandemic going on? Quickly, destroy them! Now, stomp on those mansions over there, where all the billionaires live. No, not that one. That's mine. The other ones.
With military recruitment down and the need for soldiers greater than ever, some say it's time for the military to change its policy of barring homosexuals from enlisting. Well, joining us today from the Pentagon is General Robert McBrayer. Thank you for coming.
My pleasure, Brandon.
General, the military has been easing restrictions on enlistment in almost every area, on criminals, older veterans, even those with serious medical conditions. Why not gays?
Gay people are different, Brandon. Under no circumstances can we put America's homosexuals in danger.
But homosexuals themselves are demanding the right to serve their country in a time of war.
The gays of America are the only group left untouched by war. They're special, pure and rare, like a gleaming diamond or a snow-white colt. We must protect them.
Well, has this always been the goal?
It has been the solemn oath of every man in uniform to lay down his life in defense of America's precious, precious homosexuals.
How many soldiers' lives is the life of one gay man worth?
7.
General, tell us about the don't ask, don't tell policy, which many see as discriminatory.
The reason we instituted that policy was because we knew we would never be able to keep out all the gays. To know that any of them managed to enlist and put themselves in harm's way, it would break our hearts. All of the top commanders. No, we love them too much.
So you're saying that the military's entire purpose is to fight so that homosexuals don't have to?
Nor should their fragile psyches be subjected to the horrible sights that occur on the battlefield. Their pure minds should be reserved for thoughts of man-on-man or woman-on-woman romance.
Well, thank you for clarifying this very sensitive issue for our viewers, General McBrayer.
My pleasure. God bless America and her gays.
Wouldn't you like to feel free again? Enjoy get-togethers with your friends, cheering on your team, living the dream.
Hi, Boris!
I mean, how could we forget him? It's just like forgetting Herman Finkelstein or Dorian Crundlewater or something like that.
I have in sincerity pledged myself to your service, as so many of you are pledged to mine.
I it's not been easy for me. It has not been easy for me. And, you know, I started off in Brooklyn. My father gave me a small loan of $1 million.
I have no option but to resign from the office of Premier.
Here we go, friends.
Commercial time.
You're living in the past.
The first time I really got interested in wireless was walking along the beach at Liverpool.
It's the sound of
music.
Listen to the sound.
Don't worry about a thing. But every little thing is gonna be alright. I woke up this morning on my horizon. Three little birds were on my doorstep.
And now, the man the BBC tried to gag.
This is a special report.
Welcome, 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 everybody. Here we have the Forbidden History Chronicles with the Desert Owl. We are, you know, a spinoff from The Missing Link. I am, you know, your host, Jesse Howell. We're just bringing you this information from the Desert Owl. This is all new information to me, so I'm learning just the same as everybody else is learning as well. So he breaks things down in a different perspective, and you know what the mission is to let people know, you know, who the people are that are doing these things to us. And, you know, that way, if we know who's doing it to us, then maybe we have a better chance to,
okay,
you know, stand up against them. How's it going there, Desert?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I was just going to share this out. So, so I just basically opened up, told everybody a little bit about us. And maybe if you just want to get right into,
all right,
right into going. So Ask Desert Owl with Ninja Cat says sound is 10-10.
Okay, so we're talking today about the Aryan invasion, and this is part three. And, you know, in this process I'm so grateful for Jesse Hall for giving me this platform and forum to speak, because in the process, you know, we continue to learn. And that's the beauty behind even teaching, you know, a presentation. You're actually discovering additional parts of the puzzle at the same time, and that's exactly what's happening here. It's never been more clear on the Vatican, but also on the Assyrian front, because we've covered a lot of ground in two programs. I thought I could knock it out originally in one program, and then last week or 2 weeks ago, I was surprised that, you know, I was going to actually need a third program. But there, you know, we're talking about our world history, and it's a big story, you know, and there's a lot of players, and how do we dissect and define all of those things in a short process. It's very hard to do, and I keep writing notes on new cards, you know, because I've got so many other little pieces come together, you know, and so it's to see the mosaic, you know, of all those different pieces put on the table, which is the way we're doing it, creates a picture that's never been done before, to my knowledge. Other people have talked about specific points of history or, you know, topics, but this is a standalone presentation because, you know, like I had, I got into political activism 30 years ago, so I had the opportunity to meet a lot of researchers, and then you got the other people who are not, you know, the deep researchers, but they're trying to figure things out, and, you know, and some people think it's the Bilderberg, you know, that these corporate guys are trying to take over the world, you know, like it's never been done before, or it hasn't been under control all along. because that is my contention, that the Aryan race has been running the world. That's where we get the word arrogant from, because the Aryans are arrogant by their nature, because when you run the world and you think everybody else is a slave, I think that's quite a bit of arrogance, you know. So some people then, you know, they figure, okay, yeah, it's over there in England. Okay, so it's the queen. You know, the queen is running the world. She owns all that property. You know, she's got to be running the world. And we're her slaves, you know. And then finally somebody, you know, learns that, wait a minute, but the queen, she bows down in the city of London to the Lord Mayor. She knocks on the door and bows down to the Lord Mayor of London. Well, those are the Jews. So the Queen of England's baron, and that's a code word, by the way. And now that I've said that, I better do my disclaimer, because, you know, we're talking about a group of people, but their name really isn't Jew. Okay, that's just a cover. They're actually Ashkenazis. There's the word Nazi right there. They are Khazarian, Ashkenazi, and so. Or short, Khazars for short, and that's the word Caesar. So you see all these pieces, now you know, begin to realize, wait a minute, okay, there's a Kaiser in Germany, you know, all these things that are going on. And so, you know, when we talk about race, and I'm an Aryan, so I'm beating up on them, okay? I'm beating up on Aryans, because anybody that wants to do harm to somebody else deserves to be beaten up, you know? But it's not a, you know, that's a euphemism, because we're not here to poke hatred at any group. All we're talking about are the points of history. And if we can't talk about the real history of our planet, then we're in big trouble, ladies and gentlemen. So there's no, hurting prejudice against any other group of people. It's a mix. You know, we've got bad guys that are, you know, from Africa. We got bad guys that are from China. We got bad guys that are from India, every part of the world. Okay, so we're all bad. I guess when you get right down to it, it's the serpent. That's the problem. You see, that's the real problem when we get to it, when we go down the trail of the Forbidden History Chronicles. We'll talk about that serpent, because nobody even knows who it is. What happened to him? Wait a minute. Okay, it was in the Garden of Eden, and boom, gone. You know. And so then finally, you know, when we read the Catholic Encyclopedia, we then find out that, wait a minute. We thought like the queen was bowing down to the Lord Mayor of London, the Ashkenazi Khazar Jews, the bankers that run the world. And then you look in the Catholic Encyclopedia, and then all of a sudden we find out, wait a minute, it says that the Jewish banking, Bauer, then transformed into the Rothschild, Red Shield, red for Jewish red communism, then are the protectors and defenders of the Vatican Trust. So, wait a minute. So they're not running the world, but they've been given a license to run the world through the Vatican. So it's all staged through the Vatican. But then finally, when I realized that all the out of Italy, the Jewish Khazar banking families were becoming the popes, then all of a sudden it was like, wait, now I understand why the Pope has that little beanie on his head, that little moon cap, so that the light of the sun can't shine on his brain. And it's the same one that the people calling themselves Israel today who are not Israel. AKA, they call themselves Jews, but that word only came into existence in 1775. So certainly they were not in the scriptures, and that's where we're going to go, of course, in the future. So then the Vatican, but you see, that's the front office, and so certainly, you know, the bad guy wouldn't live in his front office. If you have an operation going on, you don't live on your job. You know, you're somewhere else. Your home is somewhere else, and that's where it goes back into the ancient Aryan Brahmin, Brahmin for sovereign. It's code word for sovereign. And by the way, Bauer, the banking family, Bauer is vow for war. They took a vow for perpetual war against mankind.
We'll be right back.
and they're working for then the Brahmin, which are the sovereign. You see, so it's a layer of an onion that goes deeper and deeper and deeper. And some people get to the Vatican, ladies and gentlemen, but nobody gets past the Vatican. I've never heard anybody be able to take it further, although certain people that are closer to the insiders know that the Hinduism is a front for Brahmanism, and that is a one world Vedic order, global pyramid civilization prior to the flood and after the flood. They get, you know, like people talk about UFOs. There's always been UFOs, but they're not unidentified. They're identifiable. They go back to Indostan, okay, India. They're on the temples at the top. Those little donuts on top of the temples are models of the original Vimanas, which are the anti-gravity craft that fly all over the world. They got the primitives to think they came from the star Sirius, but truly they just came from the northern part of India, you see. But the ignorant people, how could they know? You know, they see somebody landing on a pyramid, coming out dressed in tinsel gold out of a silver shining craft, and with his blonde hair and blue eyes and bright white skin, you know, there's your they're captured by this sky god. They call them the sky gods, sun gods, and all that. So these are the people running the world. They never have not been running the world since they've been here. It's just always a reorganization program. Isn't that what they said with the thing they want to put in your arm when you supposedly were going to get sick, right? They said, well, this, we got to have a how did they put it, Jesse? Revamp the program? How did they say it? They had a term. They have a term for that, right?
Restructure,
but now there's another word. Like it's an opportunity, you know, they're gonna, I can't, it's like a new day. I can't, there's a, they have a standard phrase, you know, that they're using. I can't remember it. But anyway, so you see, it's not so easy to talk about who's running the world when you've got all these layers of the onion and people are stuck with the Bilderbergs, thanks to covert operation Alex Bones, you know, former comedian, Bill Hicks. And they're all family, ladies and gentlemen. They're all family. It's in a big extended family, you know. And I had when I was on the international shortwave, I had people, you know, in the Illuminati families that were kind of like the offshoots. You know, they're not really players. And they'd call me and they say, Dezert, hey, I've been listening to you for about 2 years now. Man, let me tell you some things, okay? And then they start telling me. And I even had one I interviewed twice. And that's how I knew that Angela Merkel was the living daughter of Adolf Hitler, because it's the same group of people, you know, and also that, of course, Hillary Clinton is her half-sister and daughter of Hitler through another woman, you know. So so the truth, ladies and gentlemen, as the old axiom goes, is stranger than fiction. And so before I go any further, I just want to point out real quick that I want to remind everyone, because we're getting out there, and I know we're getting in tough times, but I want people to be aware that if you're wanting to find spiritual truth and you want to transcend a bad world, that's the good news. That's what we'll be talking about in, you know, the future programs. That the bad news would be if this was the only world we have, but the truth is there are two worlds, a lower world, and we're in the lower world right now, and we feel it. We feel the pain for our friends and our loved ones, but there's a higher world, and the higher world is here invisibly. That's why there's a day and a night. That's the duality, okay? But I had the great fortune of acquiring a document that is Gospel of the Kaledee, and in this work is the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey used to say here in America on True Value Hardware radio broadcast when he did the news. There is 25 chapters of the most powerful gospel. It goes beyond Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John in our received scriptures, because they were filtered through the Vatican. This was unfiltered, never made it to the Vatican, written by, put together by Joseph of Arimathea. That's not his correct name. It's Volei Shefei, the sovereign, or the Ramtha, or the star ram. But so anyway, the great uncle of Yeshua brought this to England 3 years after the resurrection. And I've now got most of the numbering done. It's already posted on Amazon without all the numbering, but the numbering will be done in about a week, and then I'll repost it again. But this work has so much that I can't begin to tell you, ladies and gentlemen. But like one example, where Yeshua met Barabbas. He met him at least on one, if not two occasions. I got to go back and read it again because there's more to the story. And he gets in his face about starting a revolution, you know. So, but he was, we find out he was propped up. He was created and given the false name of Barava, which is really born Ava, meaning the son of the father. So the priesthood propped him up to be what he was as a false messiah. And there was revolution going on already in Syria, and the Roman soldiers were seeking him out, you know, because so there was another messiah, but he was the false one. And this part of the story is in there. Then the one about the false narrative about Mary Magdalene, that Yeshua somehow married Mary Magdalene from Magdala and had a baby. Not true. Right in the end of the story here, just before the crucifixion, we find out that he meets her. She anoints his feet and tells her story to him about how she was shacking up with a Roman centurion and that she repents of all of that. And so it's not possible then, based on that story alone, you know, that that she was, you know, having a relationship with Yeshua. And so there's so many pieces in there, I can't begin to tell you. And then in the back of the book, I just wanted you to see the chimera. This chimera is, you know, mentioned in Revelations, but nobody has ever presented it, you know, in all my years of watching presentations, you know. So I'm presenting for you the chimera found in Etruscan tomb in Italy and made of bronze. And so it's got a story behind it. So I put it in the back of the book. I did it the other week. You know, I brought it on the program to show you, but I realized I should put it in the book so that I've got so much in here, you know. And then here's the, you know, the story about how our language, our diction, election was corrupted. I've got the pages off center right now because I'm working on it. So it's not looking good. But the title page, I'll just show you the title page real quick on here. Okay. Major work, ladies and gentlemen, and we almost are done with it. But you can support the project and get a copy now, and then you can get the finished final product in about a week or two, and then you give the other one to a friend, you know. But this is the Gospel of the Wise Strangers, or the Kaledi, and what an opener. The preamble and the first chapter in here is a part of the work of Joseph. He tells how he had to escape England, that the Sanhedrin wanted to kill him and their family, and Lazarus, and all that is a part of the story. So I want to highly recommend it. And forgive me for being long-winded on that, but I'm excited because this book will prove out the filtering of our other scriptures through the Vatican and the City of London, with the King James Version coming out of the City of London. Okay, and King James persecuting Protestants when he's claiming to be a Protestant. That's a good one. That's how we got the Mayflower coming to America under the rule of King James the First. Okay, so amazing time we're in, ladies and gentlemen. So the world is a stage. It's a stage, ladies and gentlemen, and it is the joke is on all of us. I'll play this through because Ninja was good enough to set this up here for us, and we got two quotes coming, I think, in here. Let's see here what we got. The world being a stage. Francis Bacon, he's the real Shakespeare, you see. And American politics is the entertainment division of the Jewish Federal Reserve Bank. We'll be talking more about that later when we get to World War II. We're going to cover World War I, World War II, World War III. We got to do a quick review in the process here, though, because we've got for new listeners, we just want to make sure that they get it. And then this one, the world is governed by people far different than those imagined by the public. Benjamin Disraeli, Prime Minister of Great Britain, 1868. Well, wasn't that what I was saying? Everybody thinks it's the Queen, but the Prime Minister, he's saying, no, it's ruled by somebody you would never imagine, ladies and gentlemen. And so that's where we're going to go. And then I have this quote by Frank Zappa. I never liked his music, I got to say. I enjoyed rock and roll when I was a teenager, but Frank, I never could listen to his stuff. And there's Obama. There's Obama, Man Magazine, Yes We Can. But, you know, we know he really was saying, yes, we can, right, in his campaign. And then somebody played it backwards. And Yes We Can was My Sweet Satan. Yes We Can, My Sweet Satan, you know. And so here's Frank Zappa's quote on the illusions of freedom. The illusion of freedom will continue just as long as it is profitable to continue the illusion. At the point where the illusion becomes too expensive to maintain, they will simply take down all of the scenery. They will draw back all of the curtains. They will move out of the way all of the tables and the chairs. And then you will see nothing left but at the back of the theater, but the dark, thick brick walls looking out at you at the back of the theater. Okay, so there it is. It's all a prop. It's all a stage. They even call war theater, ladies and gentlemen, right? They call war theater. So it's a couple cute cats here, huh? Which one is real? So we'll be doing flags and symbols here in a bit, but I'm going to go now to our other document. I want to do one of a review of where am I going? I got to get used to this new routine here. Okay, here we go. Yeah, so we're going to do a review, and Jesse, you remember to go full screen with this, right? Because this was on the other programs we weren't, and people have a small listening device sometimes, so to help everybody out, and thank you for Jesse's great production here. You know, he puts out a lot of effort to produce all this. He created this new channel since he got censored on Facebook for 30 days. So very grateful for all of his effort that he supports this work. This is not about me in any way, shape, or form, ladies and gentlemen. It's about getting the word out. You know, not everyone had the ability to go down the highway that I went down, like we see in the picture here. But I had a mountain experience. I've been down the road, and I'm not a road scholar, but a road scholar, one that's been down the road and of hard knocks and extreme persecutions throughout the 30 years that I've been involved with the truth movement. I can't begin to tell you about the things that have happened to me. When you give it everything you got, there's always somebody will come along and take the rest of anything you got left, you know? And that's what's happened to me basically in this story. Even family took me for everything. I could have done if I could have saved my radio network, if I could have, where I was helping all those victims that were, their children were getting railroaded or kidnapped into CPS or, you know, all the things that were happening, to people. And I was an activist and trying to redirect people to other people that could help them, whether they were law researchers or other types of help, community groups that could support you, get you a place to stay, protect you. All of those things I had, and then between a half a dozen people, about three women and three guys, come through my back door of my radio network, and whatever they did, they sabotage you by defaming your character and saying things, that are not true about you. And then the next thing you don't have support coming in anymore. It's a real tough deal because, the secret agents are everywhere. They are in our society. And that's just the nature of the beast, ladies and gentlemen. It's why you cannot have freedom when you have secret societies. Okay. They got their own super sovereignty, and they operate on a whole nother level. And so what we're going to prove out today is, of course, that this whole thing about America is an illusion. It was an illusion from the beginning. We have parts of it in part one and two that we've already done, but we're going to continue to present this for you. And we're starting next program, should be next Sunday. We'll be going into the alphabet. We're going to start going down the Forbidden History Chronicles, but we got to do a primer. Because basically nobody knows how to read, and we're going to start by learning how to read the alphabet, okay? And so because letters are words, and they're multiple words, they have many different meanings, and then when you compound them together, they create additional meanings, and that's the foundation of reading. It's called lexicography, or these letters we call these particular letters that I'm showing here, the higher attic. They're up there in the highest pinnacle of consciousness. Okay, they are the this is the code of the spirit of life. Okay, the spirit of life gave us this. They breathed it into Adam, and that's where we get the term the nasal ray. The nasal ray was breathed into them, and so we on the first program showed the history of the word Jew, and the word Jew doesn't come until 1775, and prior to this they were using it as a code because they didn't want to be known as Ashkenazis or Khazarian. Okay, so they went by a code word, and I don't even know how to pronounce these with the G words, G-Wiss or gee whiz, you know, that type of thing. And then look at in the English, Lulu, or IU, I guess it's the capital I, IU, and then IEWI, you know, so they were working with it. They were trying to define, then they realized they just needed to create a new a letter in the alphabet, the letter J. And the letter J did not make it into our alphabet until the early 1800s. And so like with my Webster's from 1828, it's in there, but you have very few words. And the main thing is they wanted to take over all the legal terms, and that's why they all begin with a J, but it's not original. It would have been with a Y, and that's why here in the Indo-Germanic, we actually find where it stemmed from, where they were working with it from, because it's Yiwis in the Indo-Germanic, and that means law. So these people are calling themselves the law, and that's why we got judiciary, jury. Like jewelry, jury. You see, but in the original, it would be like zure for the highest, you know. But they corrupted it, and same with the Y. There's Y words and Z words. They like de jure from the French. De jure means lawful, right? But jure, it would be with the T Z, not with the J. But this is a very subtle word game that unless you really dedicate your life to it, you'd never be able to figure it out. And then we showed on the previous program how these play on words have all these different meanings. Magi, you know, wedge, you spell it, you flip it over backwards, upside down, the letter M to a W, W to an M. You know, all of these, it's a code word. It's really the ultimate anagram. Jew, the word Jew is the ultimate anagram. And so it doesn't belong to any other word. It points back to the Indo-Germanic in the U.S., okay? And this is why we see the arrogance, you know, just like we talked about the Aryan, you know, we see the arrogant. Because they know they're above the law. They like the Rothschild family said, we don't care who makes the laws, because that's their puppets anyway, right? We print the money, and so we own everything, and that's basically the bottom line.
Yeah. And so we went. I think you said it doesn't matter who writes the laws when we control the money.
That's right. They control the money. Thank you. And so we're going to get into the flags right here. So here in Australia, I threw a few more flags in here, you know, for symbolism, because signs and symbols rule the world, not words nor law. And so we got an Australian flag. This is from the Northwest Territory, or whatever they call it up in northern Australia.
New South Wales?
Okay, yeah, that may be it. So we see here, orange flag, that's the 33-degree Freemasonry. We got the red flag for Jewish communism. And then we got the black banners on both sides. We got a sun symbol over here, big sun symbol. And then here's another sun symbol, which is a six-pointed star. They call it Star David, but it's not. It comes from India, Hindustan, but it does correctly represent the star of creation. And they were going to put this star on the American flag, but they realized it'd be a dead giveaway, so they didn't put it on. Okay. And then here we've got anti-fascist, the Antifa movement, and I'll be talking about it later because this one is from Germany, 1930s. Okay, so Antifa was in World War II, just like we got in World War III, the war against mankind. The Antifa, anti-fascist, you know, they're the fascists. The funny part about it, right? They're the fascists. They're the ones wearing billy clubs. They're the brown shirts. You know, they're the ones wanting to beat people up and tear statues down and burn buildings, right? And they're calling themselves the Antifa for anti-fascist when they are the fascists. What a better way to play it, right? It's everything's backwards.
Backwards, okay? Again.
Yep. So we got the dual flag, the black and the red. The black is the priesthood, and the red is banking, the Jewish communism. So there's your overlay. The bigger flag is above, right? The bigger flag, which represents the Vatican priesthood, and then we could say the Brahmin sovereign, Hinduism. And then underneath, we got the smaller flag, which is the Jewish banking. They're doing their job. That's why they got all the money. And then what do we have here? Whoa, 1932 in the U.S., we've got when the New Deal was coming in 1933, and then the bankruptcy occurred, and the New Deal all happened, right? So we got the end of the Depression. Oh, well, the bankers, they created the Depression. Glad it's over, right? But look at the overlay here. We got the six-pointed Star of David. We've got the Nazi swastika for the Ashkenazi Jews. And then we got the all-seeing eye on a four-leaf clover that looks like the star for the Knights of Malta, Maltese Cross. Okay, all overlaid in America, 1932.
And an upside down triangle as well.
Yeah, upside down triangle. Right, the A in the pyramids, the intersecting from the visible to the invisible. What comes down is the sound wave creation, and then it comes into the visible realm. Manifested for a temporary moment. Everything that has a beginning has an end. And then one more time, we see the swastika, all sun symbols, the six-pointed star, the Star of David, six-pointed star, and then the swastika being the representative of the light particle spinning down, the philphot. It's a fan. And as Glenn Keeley said, it means, read it backwards, it's tough life. You got that right. And then the symbols, and thanks to the wonderful work of Ninja Cat down in the Sydney area, we did an upgrade on the graphics. Let me blow it up a little further here. I hate that word on the computer, blow it up. Control. And okay, here we go. Getting bigger.
I'm really trying to watch how I say what words, how I'm saying it, because I know that there's so many spells in the words. It's in the spelling. So I'm trying to be as prudent as possible with what I say and what I put out there as my energy.
I hear you, Jesse. So we see signs and symbols tell the story about all of life and the true story, the serpent story. It all began with the A. Everything comes out of the A. That was that highway that we were going down. And so all of these symbols are relative. Here we look at the G. We can see a cobra. The small G is a cobra. I got that in the Real Da Vinci Code, or the 2020 Indo-Germanic Dictionary. Then here we see another cobra, and it's a Hebrew letter for Aleph, the two L's. So they're representing sun and moon. Sun and moon, above and below. Upper, the more powerful, and the weaker. That's the tail at the end here. And then there's the L for the... The Lamed, it's called Lamed, and so it's a carrier, Lama. You hear the word Lama in there because the Lama is a pack animal. It's carrying the work. It's carrying the workload because that's what sun and moon are doing. They are creating on this planet. And so that's just a little bit on that. Then we just, and then the rest is words. We'll, if we got time at the end, I'll do some key words, and I'll go through them the way I did on the last program with these comparisons, because it seemed like people were getting it with that. Okay, and so I'll pull down from here. And let's go to flags now, ladies and gentlemen. And let's look at some flags. First, I just want to mention that if we look at this graphic real quick, showing how signs and symbols rule in the world, they're telling us something. This is Jupiter coming out of the clouds. And the hair, like on the long hair on a woman, represents silent wisdom in the ancient custom. And then, but the man, he's the one who grows a beard. The women don't grow beard, it goes down their back. And so that's silent wisdom, but when it goes through your face as a male, then it's the power source coming out, the truth of the light, the knowledge of light, the wisdom. It's representing the wisdom coming out of the male, because the male is the dominant creature. He represents the spirit, whereas the woman is the smaller creation. She represents material, the material world, the smaller creation, because the spirit is the bigger one. That's in the great mystery. That's what things we'll be talking about. Well, what's interesting is about, this is the right above the door entrance at the Rockefeller Center GE building. I believe it's the GE building. But look at the hands. Jesse, you got the this is Jupiter. His nickname is Jove. They say by Jove, right? Jove. And then, and that Zeus was the sun. There's your, where you also get Jesus from. The Jesus for the healing Zeus, but he's the son of Jupiter, yet he's the supreme god at the same time. You know, so there's this duality going on as well in this Greek mythology. But look at the left hand going over his shoulder. Isn't that a strange looking hand, Jesse?
Mm-hmm.
And then you look at the hand at the bottom, and got a really unusual position there, but you see something on the hand as well. Can you see the male-female?
Yeah.
One hand is the female, right? And so they're always doing that, right? They see they've got an obelisk, or, you know, you got the word foul, you know, the phallus terminology being used in a lot of the works, you know, so that's rather interesting. But then we scroll down here. This is from my museum section it's now a radio museum, former radio network, the realpublicradio.net, also known as freeamericaradio.com, Free America Radio Network. And so this seal we see on the back of the dollar bill is not our, you know, an American seal. You look at the shield, right? And they got arrows in one hand for war, and they offer peace on the other hand. And above it is the moon, the six-pointed star, but it's creating the moon, because we know on the other side, on the left side of the dollar bill above the pyramid, is the sun. So this is the moon. That's why it's gray in there. And this is basically the banking seal. This represents the bankers. And this is a eagle, but it's a phoenix in the great mystery, and also a vulture in the switch outs of these different symbols. Okay. But look at what we have here. Our flag has all the stripes laying down, but yet that means submission, because if the stripes are going up like we have here, we have dominance. So look who's dominant. It's the customs flag. See, they're on the border. They're in between the north and the south. And so this is the banking customs flag. And because bankers are controlling currency, commerce, and also the legal, of course. And so now we see the Swiss cross, the red cross, which becomes the Swiss banking flag, right? But also this is the symbol for the Knights Templars. And so here it is, Dutch Royal Jesuit Owned East India Trading Company flag. Whoa, rather interesting. Knights Templar, they'll become Freemasons.
Mm-hmm. Were the Knights Templar good before they got infiltrated?
No, nothing coming out of the Vatican or going in the Vatican is of any virtue. Some people actually, you know, don't get it. They think that there was a bad, you know, some bad popes, but now they're good popes, you know, and all that. You know, you can't have your foundation built upon a sea of lies, you know, and that's what it is. It's a sea of lies. It's never. And so the Knights Templars then were transitioned into Jesuits. It's always the switch out. It's a changing of names and faces, but it's always the same players, the same game. It's just another game, you know. And so we look at the British flag right here, and we see that's the cross. Remember, signs and symbols, and the X. And where do we see the symbol? Because remember, they said, did Britain conquer the world? Well, we see the symbol right in Vatican Square, right in between the circle, right? They call it a square, but it's the keyhole right outside the front of the Vatican. And so that means ground zero. And so it's showing that the British Empire, as we talked about, the Queen bowing down to the Lord Mayor of London, is just a puppet. And therefore, this is the prime agent. How the reason they say that they conquered the world, but it was really the Dutch Royal Navy. The British fleet only had about 150 ships, and the Dutch Royal Navy had about 2,500. Tell me who dominated the seas. They were founding all the places, key places, then they gave it to the British. And that's why they got them to wear red coats, because they hope they never come back. You can't miss hitting a red coat in the woods. And so they were doing the depopulation program there of England at the same time, you know. And so then we get this being the supposedly, because I wasn't there, you know, the first American flag. And but we notice it's a slave trading flag, West India Trading Company, East India British Trading Company. These are slavery flags. This flag was carrying slaves on ships, okay? And so they get us pledging allegiance to it. It's the greatest joke and show on earth, ladies and gentlemen, okay? It's not our world. It's not our American nation. It never was, and we'll be going there further, okay? So let me see where we're at here. And so we did the flags, and, okay, we got all that together. So now we're going to get into the cultures, okay? I had to do this as primary. Maybe, Jesse, we can do our first break. I'm feeling it a little bit, and then we'll come back and do some more, okay? We just went through a first round, and now we're going to be getting to these cultures. We're going to just bump back to the Assyrian culture real quick, because I was able to see more clearly certain aspects of that. And it's always the same group, you know, whether you're talking about Turks or Khazars or, you know, Ashkenazi or Hittites or, you know, what became the Syrians, which were just really Assyrians, Assyrians, you know, all these play on words. It's they're Aryans. And the Aryans are the ones that wanted to enslave mankind. Go back to the other programs. You'll hear where I talked about the Watchers. I can't go that far back. We're just picking it up with the Assyrians for just a little clip, and then we're going to move into World War I, World War II, World War III. How the game is played on you, ladies and gentlemen, is what they didn't want you to know. But we're going to tell right here because somebody's got to do it. I think I'm not telling you that that knowing this, you can fix the broken wheel, because it's always been this way. But I think everybody deserves to know who's doing it and how they've been doing it. Because then you realize that, yeah, I think I like the idea of the other world, because there's another world here right now, okay? We can embrace it. And it's by the one who made the entire cosmos. He made the entire cosmos, the active agent within our universe, Yeshua, okay? The Malashianke, or the Moshiach, or the Messiah, however you want to pronounce it, on one of those transitional levels, because there's levels of abbreviations that they've given us with our words, which is originally called the Eshavor, with a silent T at the end of it, the Eshavor, and also silent A. You can also make the A silent at the beginning, and it then becomes Shavor. Shavor, and there's the word for shower, the word for sword, and the original word for word, the Shavor, the vortex at the center of everything, the logo. All of those things are in there. But we don't get that anymore, because we went to school and we got educated. Ed means to remove everything they didn't want you to know about that we tell you right here, ladies and gentlemen. So glad you're tuned in. Hope you are telling your friends. We got a long way to go, short time to get there today. So do tell a friend, and we'll be back with Jesse Hall in just a few moments. So honored to be working with wonderful people.
And I'm at the thought process that if we do know this information and enough people know and maybe be able to come together, we can maybe stop them. So, you know, that's, you know, hence why I like to do what I do and get the information out there as much as possible, because I believe knowledge is power. And the more powerful we become, we can maybe even stop these psychopaths. So,
well, I love the political activists, Jesse, because if it weren't for them, it'd be far worse. And so the political activists create a buffer. And, you know, so, yeah, I would love for it to work, a real revolution of thinking and transition. But, you know, looking at it also from a spiritual level, I have a totally unique perspective, and I appreciate your letting me bring it on here today, because how things play out, I don't predict the future. I deal with what I see with my eyes in the present, okay?
Right. Okay, here we go.
The first time I really got interested in wireless was walking along the beach at Liverpool.
Okay, we are back.
Okay, Jesse. And I'm trying to learn how to multitask here still. I did mute out finally. Was I coming over too loud?
No, I didn't hear you through the...
Okay, good. Because got to remember all those things. I remember I had a map. Yeah, the next thing I want, I got a couple maps now since we last talked to help, on the, here it is right here. Missed it. Okay. Just going to hold that, move up here. And so now I'm getting my heater on. I'm a little too hot, but I'll just take off my warm moccasins. We got fake snow coming down actually today, Jesse. Fake snow. Can't get over it.
The stuff
nothing
that
is real anymore, is it?
The stuff that doesn't melt.
Right. That comes down at 10 degrees above freezing, and just kind of sticks around for a while. Anyway, what we're looking at in the graphic now is the trails, the ancient routes. And if I put my pointer, you can see my pointer on the screen.
Yeah.
Okay. So let me just point out, backtrack a little bit. So we see at the very top, of course, Kayseri. And it's in what is also known as the steppes. You know, and the steppes didn't have trees. It had a lot of rolling hills. And, you know, you could take it all the way to Mongolia, the northern steppes. And so they're pretty rough country up there, very cold, very desolate. To get locked in on this word would be not the thing to do, because they go by many names and faces. In fact, when we're talking about Aryans today, you know, and then we're talking about Khazars. Well, and this is, we're talking about Aryans in this particular discussion. So it doesn't make any implications about, people from, Chinese Oriental background or from, and by the way, being Aryan, you are coming from an Oriental background. It's just not the same orientation. But, so whether you're, African or Indian or whatever, the point is about the Aryan. Is that, remember I said, there was an argument about the Aryan invasion. Did it come from the West or did it come from the East? And, everybody's, having this debate going on, but it's called confusion. They're doing it on purpose, because if we look at the ancient scriptures, if we look at the ancient names of places and things, then you can actually pinpoint it, because the Aryan race began right there at what we call today the Sea of Galilee, but it was back then called Gennesaret. Gennesaret means the Garden of the Nazarene. So being that it's called the Garden of the Nazarene, and it was in, you can even find it in the Blackstone Dictionary of Judaica, okay? So they're acknowledging it, okay? Even though they're not Semitic, because they were Assyrian, and they were the Aryan prime group, not the, the blends that come later on when you mix redhead spotted with white or black with white and you get brown, all the different mixtures that occurred through isolation, through selective breeding, all these things went on with these controllers. We know that selective breeding, sure. They switch out populations. That's what they did when the northern 10 tribes disappeared. They pulled out the Assyrians pulled out the northern 10 tribes of Israel in 724 BC, that's when Israel ceased to exist almost 3,000 years ago. Then what did they do out of Babylon? They moved in the Assyrians. They moved them in and took over Syria. Okay? And so they then started practicing the traditions of Israel, because they didn't want to offend the gods. See, so they're very superstitious. And So we got a map here. So I just wanted to point out, how the one game is played out of India, because the front office today, as we talk about the Vatican, right, is the front office. But I said prior to the flood, it was Mezarim, which is falsely called Egypt, right? And so so look what happens. If Delhi is over here, and this was the central point of Aryanism in India. Right at the foothills of the great Himalayan mountains, But so there's your real front office. There's the front office, or not, excuse me, not the front office, but the back office, the secret office where they run the world, you know. But look at then what, how to get to Maesar. They get on a boat. They go right across the Persian Gulf. What's going on with that shadowing? I hate that. They go right across the Persian Gulf and then right into what we call the Red Sea today. And they come up and boom, park the boat, give the marching orders. They call it Egypt, but it's Maesarim. Maesarim. We talked about that, you know, that Mary. Mary is a corruption of Miriam, and Miriam is a corruption of Maesarim. They've done all these switch outs on us, ladies and gentlemen, to confuse us, you know, to confuse us. There's this little point right here, Sea of Aqaba. The real Red Sea crossing occurred right there, and that the Mount Sinai is right here in Arabia. Then it became the Saudi Arabia, right? Saud busters. So let me grab my notes here and see where it's going to take us. So Assyrians, and this is where I think I'm going to go back to the Word document, and I'll type the words, because if you see the word, it goes better than just hearing the word, ladies and gentlemen. So let me pull up the document. Okay. And try to bump it up a little bit. And so we got this word. Let me bump down one. And it's called Assyrians, Assyrians. And remember, because I was educated by American schools, I could spell anything differently, especially when I've learned how the real words get spelt, and I really get confused. Assyrians. And but what we have here, and these, everything is corrupt anyway, so it doesn't really matter. You get the idea. And then later, you know, lately in school, right, the last couple decades, they told them, you spell it the way you want to spell it. It's okay. Nobody knows anyway. You know, something like that, stupid in school. I mean, talk about, you know. And who was Skyping me? I thought somebody was just Skyping me. Was that Jesse? Were you?
No.
No. Okay, it was flashing. That, I guess that was Ninja. So, but let's look at Assyria, how they play with the code. You see, because it's really, you see, it's the Asia area. And you think you're going to have a label calling yourself an ass, right? You see, and so that's how they corrupted the words. But we know one thing for sure, that on the map today, you can see this word, right? You've seen it, Jesse, right?
Mm-hmm.
Asia. So you see, it's a corruption. It's the eye is a corruption. The eye has been replacing is the big voodoo letter, just like the J. The I and the J, just draw them out and learn what replaces them. You see, but literally what it means is the Asia Aryans. Let's look at that word, because it's all in the words. And then once you can read, then all of a sudden you begin to get the pictures. You see, and so literally it means. I better not use that. I don't have to reduce that font to make this one work. Pump it down. Okay. Go to try that. Okay, there it is. That's what Asia Aryan means. They're the royal eyes. Right? What do we see in the Vatican all up in the dome? You ever see all those eye sockets up in the dome looking down where they have their masks? Jesse, did you ever see that?
Yeah.
Okay. And on the dollar bill, we got above the pyramid, the eye, right? Everywhere, all the occultists, you know, the movie stars and the musicians are all doing the eye thing, right? The mm-hmm. eye, it's all about looking, right? It's all about, I'm spying on you, right? I spy. You see? And so here they are. What were the Assyrians? If we define the words, they were the royal eyes of the Aryan. Beginning to make sense?
Like the Eye of Horus?
Yeah, the Eye of Horus, right? And so there you go, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, so we got Babylon, you know, what I've been doing, you know, because I've been doing this presentation, is reviewing certain documentaries, seeing if I could find any pieces of the puzzle, Jesse, and you know, and then I learned more clearly how that there was this warfaring faction going on, you know, and it's the same thing that they've been doing all along, but it started right here. This is the first best example, and then I'll give the modern example real quick. But basically, you know, Babylon, and they used the double-headed eagle, right, for right hand, left hand. And it was a city-state. But prior to its, well, it really was there from the beginning because Nimrod founded it shortly after the flood. So Babylon, you know, was a city-state right out the gate. Nimrod, of course, was a rebel and a revolutionary and a traitor to the sovereign truth, and therefore, you know, was an outcast of his family because he was serving that you know, the watchers. Obviously, when you learn the story, but basically, then what happens is we got the northern Assyrians and we got the southern Assyrians, and we're talking about 2000 BC, give or take, you know. And so Babylon in the middle, and what they said in the documentary was, you know, prior to the late coming city state, that they were warring against each other. But once, you know, they had Babylon in the middle officially as their city state, then they no longer, the north and the south, they no longer fought. But look at the divide and conquer thing, right? We got the northern, we got the southern, right? Then that, isn't that what we got in Europe? We got East Europe, we got West Europe, right? We got East Europe communism, we got West Europe, commerce, right? We got, what's the right word for the commercial state, implying freedom. Well, no, just that they're freer, right? They're freer because they can do commerce and they can, right, have their own business and all that. You know, so you got the slaves in the Eastern Europe, right, totally terrorized by the Jewish communist front, the Red, and then you got the Western, and they're like free and just living good, right? The Western culture is really good in Europe, right? But then what we get in America, we get the North against the South, right? You know what they call it, the Civil War, but there was nothing civil about it, and the correct terminology would be the War of Northern Aggression. The War of Northern Aggression, because the North waged war on the South because they had to disrupt the flow of things and they needed to run a depopulation program. So my point here is that when you divide, you conquer. When you divide, you confuse. When you divide, you control. You see? And so that's the game that's been played all along, you know? And so Babylon became the next front office. Before the flood, it was Mitzrayim, falsely called Egypt. And then after the flood, because it destroyed that civilization under the Mediterranean and the connection of the global civilization around the world, everything was disrupted. So they had to reorganize. And so in the process, Babylon becomes the next front office. And so listen to the word, Babylon is baby lion. Right? Let me type that one here. Okay. Babylon is, let me pump it down, I guess. Okay. Is. And so where do we see the full grown lion ultimately? At the Vatican. And so wherever you see the picture of the lion, just like I showed,
So we have a comment here. Quinos Desiree says the commercial state, I believe, is the Commonwealth, like Puerto Rico.
Yeah, you can put it that way, right? So wherever you see the, was that a question? I'm sorry.
No. It's just a comment of what you were saying earlier.
Okay. So this lion is key. You see, because wherever you see the lion, that is representing the sun, but is also representing the sovereigns who are truly running the world. That will never know their names and other faces, other than, you know, we can refer to them as, Brahmin, which is a corruption of sovereign. That's the reason the word Abraham sounds like sovereign or Brahmin. You know, Abraham, he was known as Brahm before he became plural, Abraham. And there's the word Brahmin. You see, because it means sovereign. It's not the name of an individual. It's the name of the head of a tribe. He's the sovereign. He's the star ram. The literal sense is the star ram. And so the lion, when you see the lion, you know, that's telling you who the power is whenever you see the lion. Okay, just want to point that out. And so So we see here in the Vatican, of course, we see the vat of Cain. But vat is serpent, so it's the serpent.
That's why we see all the serpent symbolism all over the Vatican, and you know they call their telescope the Lucifer and all these kind of things.
Right. Not only that, but they got everybody thinking that the hat, that mitre that the Pope is wearing, they call it a fish hat, but it's not. You see, because they always lie about the symbols, right? And so they got the story going, just like they say Betsy Ross made the American flag, right? The slavery flag, right? So the same with the hat. But if you know the word, right? Because what do they call that mitre that they say is a fish hat? They call it Dagon. Well, Dagon, it just add the royal vowel, and you get dragon, the dragon, Dagon, the dragon, the one who drags on the ground. Well, that's a serpent. You see? So the word is telling you it's a serpent. And they know that nobody can read. So they're so happy to tell you to go spell, read your gospel, go spell, and nobody knows how that is a trick. You know, it's a game. They put us under their spell. So, okay, so continuing here. So we've got a split state strategy. That's the game that they've been playing all along. We see just like another example, Northern Korea, Southern Korea, right? They split Korea. It's just the way the game has been played all along, split state strategy. What a great strategy. You know, because even the rulers, in other words, even when they know they're getting their secret marching orders from, you know, Baba Gandhi, Randi, Handi, Shashish, Hashish, up in, you know, India, and he thinks he's the insider, right? Because he's got his secret Torah, the secretary, he's whispering in his ear, telling him, well, Gandhi says you need to do this, and if you do it, you'll be a good boy, and he will give you a good retirement. He said, okay, well, I'll do what Bobby said, but he don't know that on the southern side, they're also being talked to by Gandhi, Randi, Hashish, Rashish, and he's telling them the same thing, saying, you be a good boy, and you take out Bubba up north, then, you know, you're going to get a good retirement. You see? And so they're playing on both of them because they don't really know how the game is played. They only know that they're a player. Does that make sense, Jesse? Do you get that?
Yeah, 100%. They play both sides. They put each side against each other.
Yeah. They're both working for the same guy. That is expressed. In fact, that is exactly what is being expressed in the movie called The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. Did you ever see it, Jesse?
Yeah.
Okay, so you remember, they all get together, they go get the good guys, right, for their team, and they bring them all to a meeting, and they're going to meet, who are they going to meet? M, right? M, that's all he goes by, right, in a special board meeting. But M actually stands for, I better go back to the original size now. This is the perfect illustration of what we're talking about here. M is a symbol. Now, they want us to think M, you know, stands for Mary Magdalene. You know, and that's why you see the M in all the hand signals and, you know, around statues and on the walls and paintings. And, you know, they're all saying, no, that's Mary Magdalene. She married Jesus, you know, but it's not. It's about, and don't forget, it's actually two pillars. Okay. It's the I, it's the V, and it's the I. Okay. It's three symbols. These are the pillars, left and right, the Joachim and Boaz in Freemasonry, but it's also one pillar for the sun, one pillar for the moon, and out comes the virgin creation, the light. And so who is it really? And this is what they don't tell you in the movie, who M is, right? But M is the mother, you see? It's all about the mother. And so what happened in the movie, right? Oh, they're like, they get on the submarine. You notice that the Islamic thing is really, really rocking, right? Because they got this giant boat that goes underwater, and at the top of the submarine you got the lingam, right? The male female male sexual organ, female sexual organ, right on the top of the submarine, right? The lingam, and that nobody gets when they see the movie, right? And so M, all of a sudden, when they're going to go do their operation, and then all of a sudden these extraordinary men say, wait a minute, that's M doing that, that's M shooting at us. What's going on here? I'm totally confused now. Well, you see? And so M, when it looked like M was in control of everything, then all of a sudden M is the secret agent working underground to steal everything else, right? And so it's all confusion. And that's what you get out of that movie, you know, that M, who was supposed to be given the orders, now is the one who's taken everything from everybody, you know? So it's a really good illustration, you know, of the game. And M is the key word to this movie, you know, the M. Who is M? You know, let's answer the question. What we just did, it's the mother. The mother, when they talk about the mothership, you know. But remember, mother is also, right? So she's the material world. That's what she is. She's the material world. That's what they're after. You see, that's what they're taking, right? They're robbing the earth of all the final resources, and that's now why they've got to commit global genocide, because the resources are all used up. More importantly, that the ozone layer being decimated by their geoengineering, they can't grow food anymore. And so they knew this was coming. They realized that that's what they were doing. It was a suicide mission from the beginning. And and now the next word is turkey, and I think they're all turkeys, you know? I think they're just a bunch of turkeys. So let me go back to that other map now.
They're all jive turkeys.
Jive turkeys, sure. You know, they're order takers to the end. You know, once they sold their soul to a blood oath, you know, they surrender their mind. That's in the Jesuit oath. You know, maybe I should read that Jesuit oath. Well, that's too much. I got a long way to, I got some things. If I got wind at the end, I got a few things out of the Indo-Germanic or my Real Da Vinci Code Etymological Dictionary tag to do. But I do have to finish the presentation first. So let's see where we're going. So we're back in Turkey, now that you mention that, Jesse. And so Turkey, now I got to go back to words again. Okay, this is all right. At least I'm getting a rhythm. That's the important part here.
Do you think because they're, you know, Khazarians and they come from Khazaria and, you know, they've obviously spread out everywhere, but is that like maybe where their home base is, where their ties are?
Well, that's where they set up their back office, right? In other words, the puppet has to have their own state too, right? And so that's where they got their own citadel, their party, you know, their party place, right? But they were constantly attacking Constantinople, Turkey, you know, hub that we talk about, right? The hub of the crossroad right over here. You see, notice that all the trails end right here at the juncture. Here's the Black Sea and here's the Strait. And right on the other side is Europe. On this side, we have Asia, what's called Asia today. And then on the other side is Europe. And, you know, the one, before I go back into Turkey, I would want to point out this, what we call Anatolia and Cappadocia, you know, where it had the underground bases where 20,000 people can live underground, right, in those beautifully carved out volcanic rock areas. This was also the area of the Hittites. So at one point, the Assyrians are called, you know, Hittites, okay? They're all Aryans, so it doesn't matter what they call themselves. This is how it creates confusion, because who would think that the Assyrians are the Hittites, that the Assyrians became, you know, the Khazarian, right? But this is really how the game has been played. And so we got to realize, so what they are doing here is they're the watchdog. I mean, this is a remote area. Nobody would want to live there. It's not a paradise. It's not like the Garden of Eden on the Nile River. Right? This is very cold and very barren land up here, but they were gatekeepers. Gatekeepers, you know? And I'm now going to show you in the word, because that's how we can prove it out. So before I do Turkey, let me do... So the Hittites are around the time of David in Israel, right? So that's about 1300, 1200. I'm not sure. King David, yeah. About that time, getting close to 1000 BC, okay, right in that area. And so because he married the wife of a Hittite, Uriah, right? He was a a Hittite. He was a loyal soldier to Israel because they were infiltrated all the way to Egypt, all the way to Mesoraim. The Hittites were the watchdog at that time, and they were in battle constantly with Mesar, Egypt. It was no longer relevant in the watchdog story because now the Hittites were the watchdog. It used to be Mesar before the flood, but that was then, and this is now. You know, but let's look at the word Hittite. Okay, the H I for high, and then tight, which is tit. You know, tit is a point, right? We use that as for the body. We talk right, and so but it's that word is. Let's pull it down. That's the only thing that's going to work here. Okay, is let's pull this one down. Is also TIP. See, just a slight change, right? But it's the same word. Tip is tit, and tight. You see, and so it's the high tight. Hittite are the high tight. They're on a higher plane because they're working for Gandhi, Rashish out of India. You see, the Brahmin. And so they're, and remember now also that's where they found Göbekli Tepe, right? This other, you know, civilization that was buried that comes from before the flood. They got everybody to think they used buckets and shovels and buried it. It was buried by the great flood of Noah. You know, in fact, I got a great picture of that now. When we go back in a couple of weeks, you know, I'll show that pic, this new graphic I got, and you'll see, you can really visualize how the Mediterranean Sea flooded onto the land. So going back here now to Turkey, so we have two words here, and it's T-O-R-K-H-A-Y. So there's your K, right, for the Khazar. Right, Khazar. But the but Tor is power, right? So what do we get with Tor? See, so K's are for the K is, I put it down here, is the keys. It's the keys. And so what do we get with Tor? You get the words like torque, T-O-R-Q-U-E, right? If you're going to bear down on a wrench, right, you're going to give it all the torque. You can give it power, right, to tighten the bolt. And they got torsion bars, torque bars on a car, you know, so it means the torque keys, the power keys. So that's what Turkey literally means then is power. And that's the crossroad. That's the choke point. That's what Napoleon wouldn't give to Russia when they said, we'll give you anything. Just give us Turkey and Constantinople. And he said, never, never. Okay. So continuing, I know this could be boring to some people out there. I don't know if I'm losing anybody, but we have to prove out with the words, you know, that the words tell the story, and it's the only way we're going to read it because they're lying to us in the history, okay? And we can see where the switch outs have occurred. So so that's that for the moment, and. Let me minimize that. We'll go to another graphic. This will be a good one since we're talking about words. Okay. So what's interesting about this word Turkey is that there was an Inquisition that began in Spain right around the late 1400s. Okay. And the priest was a Jew, but they didn't use that word back then, but they now identify him as that. Although it was the other words, you know, that we see that we couldn't pronounce with a G or with an I, you know, I woo or, you know, woo or whatever. But of course, they're really Khazarian. That's all that we need to know. They are the Khazarian, Assyrian, Khazarian, okay? And they've always been that. So that's why they had to hide that word. So like when we see Caesar in Rome, it's still that same culture, just they spell the word differently, right? So in the Inquisition of Spain, we find out that the Jews, who were not called Jews back then, but you know, similar word, they were exempt from the Inquisition. Wow, what a special class. I thought they were the victims, but they were exempt from being burned at the stake, right? But listen to this. The Jesuit who became the Grand Inquisitor in Spain under Isabella, the queen, but he wasn't under Isabella. He was over in Isabella. He was above her. He was her handler. But the guy that was the Jesuit was also a Jesuit, right? His last name, well, his whole name, I'll just reduce the size here, and I think I'll fit it in there, okay, was Thomas. There's Turkey, right in our face, Jesse. How about that, huh? The guy's got the power word, right? He's got the power keys. You get it? Are you there?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so he's got the power keys, see? And he's the one who then, he was responsible for burning thousands of people at the stake, for torturing thousands of people underground. And there's the manna, right? He's got the food, right? He's even eating good, too. He's got all the power, the keys. How amazing. Let me see what I got here. I got a note. Audio okay? Thank you for that heads up. I'm a little loud. Okay, thank you for that, Ninja. I'll pull the mic away from my mouth a little bit. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, you know, this is why we got to really look at these pieces of the puzzle, because what we're getting in a school is only for the fool, okay? And so Istanbul, so what did when the Islam took over, right? Because I talked about it's on another card, right? Yeah, I got another on. I looked up the word in the Strong's Concordance just to confirm that they were using for law, and it was, right, T-O-R-A. And then, but then right above it, the same word with a slight variation on the vowel, we had bull. So remember, I talked about this on the other program. Whenever these quote-unquote Jews, Ashkenazis, are calling their book Torah, I said is a code word for the Talmud, they got us thinking they're talking about the five books of Moses, right? But Torah means bull, and I just proved it out in the Strong's Concordance, right? And so when Constantinople was taken over by Islam, Islam having been created by the Vatican circa 600 A.D., okay, that's a Vatican creation, then what did they call Constantinople? They called it
Istanbul.
Thank you very much, Istanbul. You see, the bull is with us, right? The bull just keeps manifesting itself in our face, and so it's quite a game they played on us, Jesse. That's why they had to control the schools. That's why they control the media. That's why this one group, this Ashkenazi Khazarian, right? Let's spell it out correctly so people get that. Okay, so we've got. Okay, Ashkenazi. I think we actually did it on the. Wait a minute, did we do that up here? Let me look. No, it would have. I don't know. It may have been down below. That's okay. I'll do it again, just to keep it easy. So what we have is the. Asia. Let me minimize that. Asia. Okay, Nazi. Okay, and then we have the other name they go by, which is the Khazarian. Khazarian, which is the the Khazarian. So they're Khazars. That's then we get. That's where we see coming up shortly after Constantinople, and you know, well, we saw that 2,000 years ago. So it was before they created Islam, 600 years before Islam was created. And we had then the, you see, and that's why they were so bizarre, right? We see these people calling themselves rulers, you know, like Nero, the extreme, he's persecuting Christians, but then we got others who are acting totally insane. You know, they do all these because they're just puppets. They're not really rulers, not really leaders. They're just having a party, right? Because they're gatekeepers. They're being ruled by their handler. And he tells him what to do, you know. And so, and if he don't do his job, then he gets booted out and they bring in another one. They use their generals or their secretaries to institute whatever it is they want, you know. So that's the deal. So let's if we can, Jesse, go to another break. And when we come back, we're going to go to Switzerland and the Vatican. And then after that, Britain. And then we'll be into World War One. And I think I'm going to be able to do it here, so.
Sounds good. Let's go to a break here.
Sad little man sitting deep in a lie. He's dead in his soul, but he'll keep you alive. Do what he says, not what he do. 'Cause the truth is for him and the lie is for you. Sad little man, but he's treated like a god. As the faithless pray to a fake and a fraud. Worship the man, pledge to his word. One shot, two shot, now you get a third. Sad little man, you better run now while you know you can. Sad little man, sad little man, you don't fool me, you sad little man. Sad little man, gonna trap you like a dog. Put your head in a net while they eat you raw. Don't ask why, just comply. 'Cause fear is the drug that the doc prescribed. Sad little man, you can watch him on the news, preaching to his choir while they learn the rules. Some feel safe and some feel healed, but they'll all hold his hand as he makes the kill. Sad little man, sad little man, you better run now while you know you can. Sad little man, sad little man, you don't fool me, you sad little man. Sad little man, and he wants your kids. Some might live while the rest get sick. So put them to the test and listen for the yell. When the truth comes out, he's gonna burn in hell. Sad little man, sad little man, you better run now while you know you can. Sad little man, sad little man, you don't fool me, you sad little man. You can't fool me, little man.
And you're tuned in, ladies and gentlemen. Jesse, back to you. Or you want me to just roll? I was talking to Jesse for the program. He seems like he just doesn't mind just kicking back and letting me do all the work. So real quick, I just want to mention, if anybody wants to get the books that we have, I've got you know, I do translate, you know, it's what I really do. This is just something I have to do because we're in trouble today. And so we talk about, you know, how the world is being run. But I've got 28 books on Amazon, on Lulu, and also on Kobo out of Australia. And if when you go there, you see a book you like and you can't afford it, ladies and gentlemen, then, you know, any size donation I will get it. We'll get it to you. I don't know if you've got our contact information anywhere, Jesse, but they could email me. In other words, if you can't afford a book, you can want it on a PDF, any size donation. If you go to the channel, Ask Desert Owl, okay, with Ninja Cat, but you could just say Ask Desert Owl, three words, and right on the top right, you'll see where it says ministry donations. You can click on that, and then you make your request. Tell us what book you want, and we can get it to you. If you don't have the funny money, then you can email me at Forbidden History Live, three words all together, Forbidden History Live at gmail.com, and I'll be glad to get you whatever book you're looking for. You just tell me, okay, and we'll get it to you on PDF. So we're here to share, okay? There's nothing to gain on this planet, ladies and gentlemen. And you know, roof has been put over my head, and I, you know, I have food to eat. Ninja's in a bad fix right now. Ninja gets a part there in Australia for all of her work for this ministry. She gets a percentage of everything that comes in, and she's toughing it out. So if you do support this ministry, you will be helping a lady down under, and who's really down under now, under the gun, and they're going to be forcing everybody in December. So she's got some things she needs to get prior to that, because she may not be able to go to the store. Okay, literally, may not be able to go to the store anymore after December. So any donation goes to help her as well. And so we sure appreciate your consideration. If you're doing okay and you've got a few extra phony dollars, that's a good one. You know, then do consider helping. Okay, because so she helps this broadcast unflinchingly with the labor of love. And I wish I could, you know, could really pay her, but I can't. So anyway, we're in Switzerland now, ladies and gentlemen. And it was founded just as the Knights Templars had disbanded. Okay. And it's interesting the time that it took to, there I am multitasking again. I love that. Just as the time it took to get back to the mountains, that's when Switzerland was formed. And what's interesting, it's the it's Tsarland. You see the word Tsar is in there, and that's the star. So it's Tsarland. I had the transliteration of the front part, but I think it is Shah. It's a code for Shah, very possibly. So it's the means royal. It means the royal star, the land of the royal star. Okay, that's the Switzerland. And then what's interesting is because you know the Vatican ultimately then becomes the front office through the Roman Empire. Roman Empire, a political state, morphs itself. First, it splits itself into two parts, and Constantine goes to Turkey. Right, sets up the Eastern Empire at that crossroad. And then at the same time, you know, that Roman Empire adopts Christianity, but it was a phony Christianity. It was a political move because you control people through religion. And then those people who had not followed their particular dogma doctrine then would be excommunicated, tortured, burned at the stake, what have you, in prison. And then Rome and Italy is converting itself into the final phase of that religious state, and so it goes to the east, then it comes back to the west, and then we've got a religious state from a political state. And what's interesting then is to show that these people are all connected. My point being that the people who call themselves Jews today are running the Vatican. It don't matter if they got black cardinals or Chinese cardinals, you know, people of other cultures, Hindu cardinals, because that's a show, because they bring everybody in to create a good front, but it's still Aryan at its core. And so what do we have? Who guards the Vatican? The Swiss Guard. They guard the Papa. And Papa means evil in the Indo-Germanic. I had looked that one up. It actually means a couple other things. I can't remember it off the top of my head. Okay? So the priesthood is at the inner circle. And so priesthoods are running the world, not politicians. They're the puppets. And so, so it's been pointed out by others, okay, by others. I even knew somebody who found the tunnel of a Catholic church that went underground in Rochester, New York, into the Protestant church. You know, they had an underground tunnel between both churches, and it was when they were doing construction. You know, there I think they were demolishing one. I can't remember the story, but who I used to interview, David Bill Hughes, he wrote the book Secret Terrorist, exposing the Jesuits, the Jews that were Jesuits. He said that you'll always, in different countries, you'll always see the Catholic Church right next to a mosque, right? Always right next to a mosque, because underground, they have their underground tunnels, and the priesthood is the inner circle. They know what's going on. They know that all the religions are under their control, and it's a front, that we're the puppy dogs out here thinking it's legit and real, and we're doing the bidding of our master, but at the same time, it's all a phony stage, as we, you know, talked about it at the beginning, theater. It's all a stage. And there's the inner circle, there's the outer circle. They got the outer circle fighting each other, talking about dogma. Well, no, you know, this is the doctrine that we follow. You got to follow the doctrine. You know, they're talking doctrine like it really matters when it's all phony at the center. You can't have a corrupt tree, you know, and think you're going to get purity out of a corrupt tree. And that's how the game is played with religion. They got us all fighting each other. You know, the Seventh-day Adventists are fighting with the Jehovah Witnesses, or they're fighting the Mormons. You know, Mormonism is the most perfect example of another version of Freemasonry. You know, it's just amazing. And so in fact, even, you know, the head of the ADL, which is the Anti-Defamation League, you know, so the Jewish Front, you know, the Khazarians, they have actually an organization to identify hate speech. You know, if anybody talks about them, it's hate speech. And so the original logo actually had the letter A of ADL right at the top of the world, showing that they dominated the world. And if we don't remember, I mentioned the word Bauer was a code, and it means the vow for war. And the war that they were talking about, the vow they took to have the position working under the unseen hand, is the vow for perpetual war, nonstop, continual war against mankind. Okay? And that's what they've done. That's why we see the poverty. We didn't have to have poverty, you know? And so what does the head of the ADL do? By the way, that background noise is coming through, Jesse, so you're aware. The head of the ADL kisses the Pope's ring, goes to the Vatican. And when I saw that, it was like, you know, I was scratching my head, you know, because I didn't have all the pieces yet, you know? And it's like, okay, he's going to kiss everybody, all the Freemasons, the Schulers, the Pat Robertsons, all of the, you know, all of these idiot preachers that we see on television, all going, you know, from Protestantism, going to kiss the Pope's ring, you know? And so that shows that they're all secret agents, you know? And, ladies and gentlemen, it's amazing. So with the Knights Templars, we got the Hospitallers. That's where we get the word hospital today. You know, that's why now they're committing genocide in the hospitals, because it's run by secret societies. Secret societies, ladies and gentlemen, running our world. Okay, now let's go to Britain. Okay, and so Prime Minister of Great Britain, Benjamin Disraeli, in 1868 said, "The world is governed by people far different than those imagined by the public." Okay. So he knew he was an insider. He knew something. But he didn't tell it. He didn't give us the whole story, did he? He just let us wonder, what is he talking about? Well, he's talking about the city of London, run by the Khazar Ashkenazi. What part of Nazi don't we get? Jews, okay? And so the British flag. So let's go back to the flags one more time. Show where are we on here? I got Oh, here we go. Okay, flags. Oh, that, love that one. Let's block him out of here. Well, that's okay. I'll leave it here for now. Okay, that flag again, the British flag. That's the Vatican. Okay, and the X marks the spot and the cross, right? And so that's Vatican Square. And so that shows that. So we got three layers of the onion. The flag is showing the Vatican. The city of London is showing the Rothschild Jewish front. And then we got the British crown, right? The British crown. But they reign. They don't rule. When you reign, that's why they got the prime minister. Because when you reign, you don't have to be involved in management of administration of the government. You're just having a party. But the ones who rule, that's the parliament. That's the prime ministers, you see? And so... So Britain conquers the world, but a little tiny island nation conquers the world, right? Well, I told you that the Dutch Royal Jesuits, the Jewish Front, had 2,500 ships, Navy ships. So they're the ones who are conquering the world. Then they set up the British front office of the Vatican, secondary front office, agent, around the world. And so... So let's go back to Napoleon. So how did this happen? How did the Khazar Jews take over? How did they take over England when it was it was the Normans who took it over from the Saxons? How did this all play out? Well, what happened was Napoleon was being used for his final showdown, and he was going against he was there at Waterloo. I can't remember who he was fighting now, whether it was the Normans or the English. You know, I don't remember that part of it, but this is the part I remembered because it was so important. And it was, by the way, Waterloo, right? It's called Waterloo. And water, we know what that means, but loo means protection. So literally it's the waters of protection. And so what a metaphor. Because the Rothschilds running England were telling the royal family, you know what? Napoleon's going to win the war. He's going to come over here and he's going to kick your butt. And so the royal family, the Rothschilds, told them, we'd be glad to buy your stocks and all your property from you if you want to escape and leave the country. We'll give you a penny on the dollar. How about that? That's a good deal. You take it or leave it. You know, it was the only deal they had. So that's what the royal family did. They sold all of their property to the Rothschilds for a penny on the dollar. And then they're getting ready to leave. And then the courier pigeon comes in with the information that Napoleon lost the war, but they held the information for 24 hours and acted on the stock market. Rothschild put a flower in his shirt pocket. And if you put the flower in the shirt pocket, that was the sign for everybody to buy up all the stock of all the British companies, you know. And so they literally bought through fraud, through the fear of war, waging war. That's their job, right? They wage war on mankind. And they are the media. They deal with information. And there they were using a carrier pigeon. They then defrauded the British royal family and took over England, owned it, wholesale stock and barrel. And then they tell them, well, look, okay, maybe we lied to you. Maybe we were wrong, But anyway, now you're working for us. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to work out a deal, and we're going to let you reign. You're not going to rule, but we'll let you reign, and you can have your castles and your property around the world. And here's the deal. Whenever you need money, we'll create bonds. Can you say slavery? We'll create bonds, and then so we'll give you all the bonds you need. And in exchange, we're going to then tax the people for whatever we want. Okay, that's the game. And we'll put them in bonds. We'll make them the surety for these bonds. And we'll get the money back through the slave labor of the people. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is exactly what they did here in America.
Through the birth certificate.
Well, the birth certificate is the slave document. Right, that's what they monetize. For every birth certificate, they put $1 million or... now about $1.5 million in circulation and commerce, just numbers on a page, but it looks good, And so that's how they enslaved mankind in the modern, ladies and gentlemen. They didn't need gold or silver. They just needed a good imagination and well, good slaves.
Yeah, they took away all the gold and the silver. Remember when they had to take everybody's gold? It says illegal to hold any gold there in America.
Yeah, they put it in Switzerland or Germany or wherever they wanted to stick it. Britain, okay? And so the American flag is a slavery flag. And so we were made slaves. In fact, you know, I was dealing with the other day, Jesse, I'll do the typing because it looks better when you can see it. You pull that Word document up. Okay, this I saw for the like for, I you know because you may have remembered I talked about the battle between the letter L and R, just like alien is Aryan, right? Change the L to an R, and these are the royal vowels. These are royal vowels that nobody taught us in school. They're vowels. There are no restriction. Even H is also a secret vowel. So in the L and the R, right? So when we look at the word self. If we change that magic letter, we get slave, right? Surf. And come on, unload these ships, slave. You know? So that's, that's just a new, you know, they keep opening up over time, you know?
And that's why we're here surfing the waves.
Yeah, we're surfing on the waves. That's right, the airwaves. We got another card here? Okay. You have the double-headed eagle, right hand, left hand. And oh, there's your R and L. R and L again, right? Right and left. You change the vowel because the right is the light and the left is reft of light because it's the weaker arm. And so then Adam Weishaupt, a Khazar Jew, he sets up the Bavarian Illuminati. I didn't write down the date for that, but ultimately what happens is in England, which is now, you know, the banking front. The Vatican is the religious state. The city states, right? The city state of Vatican is the religious. Then the city of London, the city state of London, is the commercial, the commerce, okay, political of the state. And then the final Washington D.C., the third city state, is the military. That's why they're everywhere in everybody's backyard, right around the world. The military, the whipping boy. You get out of line, we're going to get Hillary Clinton, the Secretary of State, bombing you to pieces, Tripoli, right? What they did to Libya, right? They even killed their own ambassador. You know, amazing. They let this guy get tortured, you know, by the Islamic Front over there. They took out Gaddafi. You know, the word Libya means liberation. The Libyan state was the only Islamic state that actually treated women with respect. He gave everybody that got married a free house, free telephones, free medicine. He gave all that oil money back to the people. If there wasn't, there couldn't have been a better Islamic state if there was one. And that's why they took him down, because he was a real deal. You know, he wrote the books of the history of Libya. You know, he was a scholar. Go ahead, Jesse, jump in.
Yeah, so what they did was with him is because, you know, all these things you said is, you know, correct. And, you know, if someone got married, they gave them $50,000 to buy a new house. And he did all these really good things for the people. But how they justified them taking him out was because he wanted to put the world on the oil on gold standard.
Yeah, an African gold currency.
Yeah, and he wanted everything to be back on gold instead of the petrodollar, the American dollar, you know, the paper money. He actually wanted it to be backed by something, and, you know, supposedly that's why they took him out.
Yeah, he went against the Jewish banking, bottom line, you know. And so, you know, you don't go against the ones who are running the world for the unseen hand, you know, and that's what happened. So, yeah, so we got the Bavarian Illuminati. And then the Illuminati found America. Before I get into World War One, I just have, for any new listener, have to just say that basically, you know, I did this presentation, so you got to look at the other broadcast. But basically, the letter J was created for the word Jew. They finally got the word the way they wanted it, the code word, the anagram, the greatest anagram there ever was, probably. And And so they, the Jews founded America in May 1st, Mayday, Mayday, because that's a code word. That's why, with the Illuminati's, May 1st, 1776. And then two months later, we get the July, the 4th of the July, the four for the four directions, because they rule the world. That's why it's four number and not number one. But it's the July, you see. And because there's a maxim of law that says that which is first is superior. And so if America is founded by the Jewish banking first, then this, you know, pretended, you know, American free state was all a big lie. And we see the evidence of it with the War of 1812, you know, or the Bill of Rights, right? The Bill of Rights, which is a bull. Remember, if it's a bill, it's a bull, because you just changed the one vowel. And so all the bills are coming down, but it's a bull from the Vatican. Where was I going with that? That you know, if it were legitimate, why did the Bill of Rights not come until about 5 or 7 or 8 years later? And they say, oh, well, maybe we ought to create a Bill of Rights. But wait a minute. If you look in the Black's Law Dictionary under the word bill, a bill is something that can be passed into law. So a bill is not law. So a Bill of Rights is nothing, because it was never enacted judiciously. Love that word now, right? But because the point is, we all have natural rights. And so they could have simply said, these are the laws of nature. These are the natural laws of man. You know, man meaning criminal and sinner now, of course, we know that. But, you know, so the whole thing about the Bill of Rights, that was a fraud. I showed you on the Declaration of Independence, the first name was the States of America. There was no United on it. It was States of America. I showed that on the word America, the first letter A was actually a GH, which is the number, which is the code for return, just like you got the GH in the middle of your keyboard on your computer, right in the middle. It's the middle of everything. The GH, that's why it's in the book of Genesis. Every 50th word in the Hebrew of Genesis, not the original Aramaic, but the one that they fabricated, has a GH, meaning return, 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 return. Okay? And so anyway, I want to point out that America was founded by the Bavarian Illuminati, which are also took over Freemasonry, and they formed a Grand Lodge in 1717. They brought all Freemasonry under one umbrella organization in England, where that Jewish banking is, right? And they created the Grand Lodge June 24th, also known as St. John the Baptist Day, June 24th, which is a celebration of the summer solstice, the longest day of the year, as if they love the sun when they really do love the darkness, and they prefer the winter solstice. You know, so I just wanted to add that, because now we're going into World War I, finally get there. And we've got the word soldier, because we're going to be talking about war. And so let's look at this one. I'm going to go back to it. Word doc. Okay, so we've got soldier. S-O-L-D-I-E-R. Did we lose all our audience, Jesse, or we still got listeners?
No, yeah, we still got people.
Good. Okay. I'm sure their heads are spinning, like, you know, desert slow down or something, right? But there's so much ground to cover. And
we're actually doing pretty good for our, you know, just being on our new YouTube channel. We've got 12 people here with us. So
wonderful. We want to welcome any of our new listeners. We probably have some friends here. And but look at soldier, right? Soul dyer, right? They're the soul dyers. They have agreed to be a pawn in a game on the chessboard. On the chessboard. And so then what happened in this period, because we're talking about the World War One would have been about what 1917, right in that area. I think by 1919 it was over. But we have
So I was just here on one of these, the Adam Weishaupt and Illuminati. He created in 1776, May 1st, 1776.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That was the same year they founded America, and they celebrated in the square of Moscow, Red Square. The day they founded America is the day they founded international communism, the Jewish banking, and they celebrate it every year, May Day, May 1st, in Red Square in Moscow. Thank you, Jesse. Important point.
And I just wanted to, right here, it's, you know, it says the Illuminati, you know, did plenty of unusual things. They use symbols like the owl. So I just want maybe you to, you know, talk about, you know, your owl being the desert owl, not in connection with, you know, any of the Illuminati for anybody who's, yeah, you know, may wonder about that.
Yeah, I've gotten a bad rap for, you know, with the statue of Moloch or whatever that is over in Bohemian Grove, right? And, you know, so yeah, that they see there's an owl on the dollar bill. On the front side, on the top right in the curve of the number one, there's a number one is in a box. There's a little owl there. He's got his head turned, looking at you. But you see that because they're owls. In other words, let's look at the word again. Words again. Since we're talking about that, and priest. So let's look at the word priesthood. Okay.
I'm just going to use the washroom, so you're not going to hear me for a sec. I'm just going to mute it, so just keep going.
All right. Okay. Priesthoods. Jesse's missing it. All right.
I'm not missing it. I have my speaker volume up, so I can hear what you're saying. I just can't say anything.
Okay, good. Well, yeah, so priesthood is priesthood. Priesthood. You see, there's another battle, just like there's a switch out between the R and the L, the secret vowels. There's a switch out between the D and the T. Now, we know the T represents life because it represents Yeshua, transcendence, and also the four directions. But the D is the death letter, the D and destruction. And so basically, you know, in nature, you know, let's just put it this way. The owl got the bad rap, right? Because the owl is the mystical bird that sees in the night, and we hear it at night going hoo-hoo, hoo-hoo, at night, and so he's a bird of mystery. But literally, as within our world, there's a dual system. It's duality. There's the good and there's the bad. So there's the white owl and there's the priesthoods, the black owl. They wear black. Okay, so I wear a white hat, and so I hope that answered your question, Jesse. He's not back yet. So in the Bolshevik, so what happened was, the question would be, you know, what's going on now? There were three wars projected by Albert Pike after the Civil War. He wrote the book Morals and Dogma, and right in there he wrote that they were going to have three world wars, and in the Third World War they would destroy all of Christianity. He acknowledged in there that their goddess was Lucifer, but Lucifer is just an idea. Like a corporation, you know, it's only propped up by the men who wear dresses, or the Scottish Rite who wear the kilts, or the priest who wears the dress. You know, that's why all the priesthoods, whether it's Islam or Hinduism or, you know, in the Vatican, they all wear dresses, right? Because they're representing the woman, they're representing the mother, and they're representing the Lucifer, the light of fire, the Lucifer. But Lucifer is only. Oh, geez, what did I do? I keep doing that wrong. Okay, I'll get this right. Lucifer. I'm gonna have to type a word again. I hope this is popping up big enough for you.
Yeah, it's on full screen.
All right. Lucifer is this L O O C I P H E R. You see, in Lou, as I said, and with that other word, Waterloo, right? Okay. Are true. Okay. I gotta bump it down. Are true, protective. Because, see, Lou, the word low by itself, like we see it in our King James, right? Low means true. Okay, when you put the two O's together, it means protective. You see, so it's two words in here. And it could also mean with this, this is a symbol of time. While these are symbols of sun and moon, it also could mean throughout time. But nonetheless, so Lu means true protective or true protector, and cipher, as we can see it, means a code. So that's all Lu, and so they have a dress code, and then they have the codes with the words, go spell, gospel, right? The go spell. And, you know, maybe I should take a, well, I'll wait to save that to the end, because I'm going to show some codes. If I can make it all the way to the end here, we may have to do part four, but at least we're getting into the wars now. But what happened was, with the First World War, they needed to get full control of things, because what happened, what's interesting, you see, when Ivan the Terrible, you know, he was a terrible guy in Russia, right? They didn't like him very much. That's why he was called Terrible. He escaped Russia because, you know, these people wanted to kill him, and he went to the Vatican. And they say, Ivan, what's your problem? You got to start dealing with the people correctly. And so when Ivan the Terrible comes back from the Vatican to take back over control of Russia, he comes back with a new alphabet because they didn't have an alphabet. Now, you know what that Russian alphabet looks like. You wouldn't want to learn it. And at the same time, they got a family name, a new name. They were called Romanovs. And then after Ivan the Terrible, you get Peter the Great, you know, and they're working with the Prussians. Prussians are teaching Peter the Great. Who were the Prussians? Prussians are those who call themselves Germany today, or the Deutschland of that time, you know? And so even Germany was called Prussia at one point. You know, it sounds like Russia, right? But PH in front of it would mean the creators of Russia. Ah, the creators of Russia. All right. You know, that's making sense. But anyway, what happened was this Romanov family, they even got the name of Rome, right? And the Jews are their agents, and yet the Romanovs don't want to play ball. They don't want to play ball because the final line of the Romanov family, was in Nikolai Romanov, trying to remember now, but he had several beautiful daughters and a son who was a hemophiliac, and they were engaged in a warfare that was being waged against them on the battlefield, right? And in the process, actually, that was World War One, you see? And so when World War One started, then, you know, they're having to get on the battlefield. And, you know, the people aren't happy. You know, they want to, you know, he's got a big, big piece of land, you know? And so a lot of different cultures. They spoke like 10 different languages and did 10 different parts of Russia, you know? But he didn't want to set up a centralized bank. He wanted to stay independent. You know, he wanted to be free, right? He don't want the Khazar Ashkenazi Jewish banking coming in and taking over, which is what they would do, right? But he was one of the royal families, you know? And so he was a black sheep of the family, you know, that he's not. While all the other European nations had a Rothschild Jewish bank, Ashkenazi Jews, he didn't want it. He knew that they would be then the ruin of his nation. He was really a good guy. He wanted to be real imperial king, you know? And so when World War II starts, Chase Manhattan Bank gets 100 kites out of New York, Jewish kites. Maybe where we get the term go fly a kite, I don't know. But they then with Lenin, put them all on a rail car with a rail car full of gold and went into Russia while World War One is going on, and he's on the battlefield fighting a war, and they move in and they buy out the people with all the gold because people aren't stupid. They don't want paper. If you're going to buy people out, you got to be able to buy people out with real currency, and the current of the sea that's real is gold. And so they then have the Bolshevik Revolution. And the Bolsheviks were the 100 kites that came in on the train, right? Even though the word Bolshevik actually means, get this, majority, right? So the majority that wanted the revolution were the 100 kites that came from New York City, funded by Chase Manhattan Bank. And so they then overthrow the Romanov family. And in the process, when the Jews want you to cry crocodile tears for 5 million so-called potential Jews that were killed in World War II, which really didn't happen that way. That's a story for another day. The Jews were very happy to murder anywhere from 50 to 60 million Russians, Christians, Jehovah's Witnesses, and you name it, other peoples, 60 million, put them to slave labor in Siberia, you know, making railroads across the great wilderness of Russia, you know. And then on top of that, the Chinese, working with the bankers as well, killed 80 million of their people at the same time. Okay, so they wanted you to cry over 5 million, which was a show, because we'll find out about that. Okay, we're talking about 60 million and 80 million. What's that add up to? 140 million people in the turn of the century, in the early 1900s, all by Jewish banking. Go ahead,
Jesse. And not to forget the Native Americans, the indigenous. There was 100 million here, and now there's only less than 10 million left. So that's another 90 million to the total. But nobody ever talks about that or cries, you know, any spilled milk on it over that.
Yeah, I used to interview the royal chiefs up there in Vancouver area, Chief Capilano. And he told his story about how he was tortured by the Jesuits, and they tied him, chained him to a stake out in the field, and hoped that the lions would eat him at night. And one of the mountain lions came down and walked around him, but he said that the lion had more respect for him than the Jesuits, because the lion wouldn't touch him, wouldn't hurt him.
Wow. You know?
Yeah, but the record was that about 150,000 natives right there in Vancouver area were genocided over about a 50-year period. And so that's your Vatican. That's your working with the Jesuits, you know, with the Jews. And you know, so naturally they got to portray themselves as the victims, because they're the murderers. They're the ones following the Babylonian Talmud. The Vatican follows the Babylonian Talmud. Israel, who are not Israel, follow the Babylonian Talmud, who don't follow the Torah, which you think is the five books of Moses, but follow, as it says in the Kabbalah, that the Torah is the Talmud, okay, which is the handbook for global domination, world Zionism, okay? Okay, I'm looking at my notes here. So what happened was, then they overthrow the Romanov family. They actually, after they murdered them, they were so vicious that they then put their bodies in sulfuric acid to dissolve them. And they dumped their bones, what was left of them, in the woods out there. Somebody actually found the decayed remains, you know, but they literally wanted to destroy the remnant of that royal family. Their hatred of you and I, of people who they call goyim and cattle. We don't hate them. They hate us. They have derogatory terms for us, like Yahoo. That's a good one. Why would you ever want to have an email account called Yahoo, right? When it means like goyim and, you know, other stupid things. You know, it's just they play the game on us, you know. Okay, so there were 1 million. So in World War One, there were actually, now remember, I proved out on the other programs that German means Jews. It's the seed of the moon. German is a code for seed of the moon, and that, which means they're of the darkness. That moon represents their Lucifer, right? It's in the darkness, shining in the darkness, because they work in the darkness. There were 1 million German Jews fighting in World War One for Germany. 1 million. I mean, come on. Most militaries don't even have 1 million soldiers, and they had 1 million Jews. Are you getting the picture?
Wow.
You see? So we're gonna pick it up now on World War II. I think is. Do I have one more card here? Let's see. Oh, I've got one more. Well, yeah. So what happened? This leads into World War II. So they all of a sudden the Kaiser, notice that the leader of Germany is called Kaiser. You see, it's the same name game as in Rome, who had the Caesar. I mean, Jesse, didn't it ever scratch your head when you heard about there was a Kaiser in Germany, then you heard there was a Caesar in Rome? Didn't you ever wonder about that? I mean, I did in my lifetime. You know, I said, what's going on with that? You know, did you ever notice the similarity? One's with the K, one's with the C, right? And so, you know, now I know, but it's taken a lifetime to get the picture, you know, because nobody's telling us. And so, you know, this information is is critical to set the record straight, for one, and it's critical because then you know how the game is played and you don't want to be a player on the game field anymore. You know, that's why now we're in World War III and they're coming for us. It's out the gate, right? They don't have to put on military battlefields anymore because now they're coming for us in our home, right? They're coming right to our door. They don't need to send us away anymore because they're coming to our door. And so what happened was they set up the League of Nations, right, circa 1918, 1919, and it was the precursor to the United Nations. And they said, okay, so Germany says they don't want to wage war anymore. They're tired and they want to go home. But wait a minute. Wait, you can't get away with murder. They set up machine guns. And then they tell the stupid, British and the French and the Americans and Australians. Oh, and Turkey was involved. Turkey was fighting with the Germans. Go put two and two together. They were fighting. They made a movie about an Australian runner, right? And he was like working as a cowboy out there in Australia. And then World War I happened, and he's got to join the military. So he joins the military, and then so they're going to go to Turkey, right? Whereas many went in France and Belgium on the front line of Germany. This guy from Australia with other Australians went to the front line in Turkey, working with the Germans, put two and two together, the Khazars, and then they're told, now you guys are going to jump out of this ditch, and you're going to run after those machine guns, right? Like, me and what fool, are going to run after a machine gun. So that's what they did. They convinced these guys that they got to take out the machine guns, and so this guy that was the star of the movie, when he finally gets to Turkey, the next scene is he gets up out of the ditch, and he runs after a machine gun, and he's dead before he gets halfway across the field, And that's the game they played on us. They got, while the Germans and the Turks are sitting in their machine gun nest, all the other nations are sending their people to rush against machine guns. You know what I'm saying, Jesse? I mean, it's insanity, right? How come we didn't have machine guns, right? How come the Germans didn't run after ours, right? The 1 million Germans, right? How come they didn't run, right?
Yeah, it doesn't sound very fair.
It was all one-sided, right? We're going to chase the machine guns. Give me a break with rifles, And that's how they played the game. So what the reparations was, here's the deal. The reparations, Kaiser, you're going to Holland. That's Dutch Deutschland, right? He's going to live in retirement smelling tulips. He's not going to go to prison. And which is the Jesuit enclave, right? And then they're told, the Germans are told, which are really the Deutsch. Remember, there's a difference between the word German and Deutsch. And Deutsch are not Germans. A Deutsch is torch. I pointed out that it's the ones who are carrying the torch. There are like two different factions of Germans. Once the Ashkenazis came out of Khazaria and Turkey, they went all over Europe and settled. And because Aryans look like Aryans, like you could have been a Jew. Jesse and I wouldn't know it because you're an Aryan. Or I could have been a Jew and you wouldn't know it because I'm an Aryan. That's why when we look at Hollywood, we see all these beautiful actors, right? And like the majority of them are Jews and they changed their names from Bernie Schwartz to Michael Douglas, right? So this is the greatest show on earth. And so what they're told then is, okay, and it's a front. Remember, this is all this secret handshake club in the back room, right? But this was the front, the stage in their theater. They say, okay, Germany, you've been really bad. And so what we want you to do is pay back war reparations of $20 billion or something like that. And then at the same time, you can no longer make weaponry of warfare. You can make airplanes, but you can't make military airplanes. You can make trucks, but you can't make military trucks, right? So you can make weapons, but you can't make machine guns, right? So they had all these rules that Germany had to follow, right? And how did the game play? When, remember now, that the Jewish banking took over Russia, and now all the European nations, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, were under the control of the Jewish Rothschild banking system, right? So Jewish banking, Ashkenazi Jews are running for the Vatican, everything. They are the Vatican. That's why Mein Kampf was written by a Jesuit, right? So how did Germany get around the rules where they could not, make or test military equipment? Well, they went to their Jewish buddies in Russia who annihilated and assassinated the Romanov family, and they said, "Hey, we need your help. We need to set up bases in Russia. Oh, come on over. You're our Jewish buddies, you know?" So Germany sets up German military bases. And I saw this, Jesse, on a documentary, okay? This was like 3 months ago. It's in a documentary. It's all an open secret. There is no secret. The documentaries are telling you now, big time, because they keep up on the mountain since they control Hollywood. They control media. They control everything. They're now spilling the beans. You see, because they want their brothers to know how the game is played. Just don't worry. Just do what we tell you to do and you'll be okay. You see? And so Germany, after World War I, before World War II, in the 1920s and the 1930s, set up military bases in Russia, and they built all of their tanks, all of their machine guns, all their bombers, everything in Russia, and they had their bases over there to test them. Smelling a rat, Jesse?
Oh yeah,
smells like a rat. And so. It's all brotherhood, secret brotherhood, And so then when World War II comes, let's see what happens. Okay,
does now being, Jewish, is that not a religion, or are you born into it, or both?
Well, no, if you're talking about Ashkenazi who go by the label of Jew, which is not a national identity, but it is a cultural identity, And the genetic identity is Ashkenazi, Khazarian, and have nothing to do with Shem. So to be called an anti-Semite is the biggest joke on the planet, because they're not related to Shem, the son of Noah, in any way, shape, or form. They are originally Assyrians, who were Asia-Aryans. They corrupt the word into Assyrians because they don't want us to get the pictures. So they have total autonomy. Just like during a war, the Red Cross, right? Knights Templars, Hospitallers, they have complete autonomy during a war. They can go on the enemy side, they can go on this side, they can go on the other side, and they can tend to the wounded. And, okay, I'm too loud. I think Ninja's telling me. I'll pull my mic up. Thank you, Ninja. And I love that technology. So what it is, see, so they're totally autonomous. Think about it. They're in every country of the world, right? They're running the banks. And so in other words, that's why I say that all the nations are imaginations, right? She was implying I was too loud, you're too low, Jesse. So just make sure you speak up. I'll try to pull my mic away from my mouth a little bit. But do you see what I'm saying? That they're international, that they're building the stage. In other words, what I showed at the beginning, right? This down right here, right? The global stage. You there, Jesse?
Yeah, the world is a stage and we're all just the actors.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. So there are no nations, they're only imaginations. Because they put it in our mind, right? That these are real. But when we look at the game, the way it's played, we know that there's something different to that story. So in Germany, they have the Antifa. They had Antifa in 1930s, and that means anti-fascist, right? And so who ran Antifa? It was the Communist Party. They were in Germany. The Communist Party, the Jewish Communist Party, who also ran the banks, right, were in Germany in their face as Antifa, meaning they're anti-fascist. Well, Hitler is the fascist, right? But he was a Rothschild bastard, right? He was the son of a maid. If you watch a documentary today, they're going to tell you he had a father and he had a mother, but that's all a front. Remember, they control media. They control documentaries. They control Hollywood. They control it all. And that's why they got us watching all these war movies, right? They never stop. They got us on the pill, just being entertained by but we never question it, you know, right? We're just watching it, soaking it up, soaking it up, soaking it up, but never stopping, getting off of the merry-go-round of their propaganda. The greatest propaganda show has been on for 100 years of late, but they've always controlled entertainment, you know, from the Greek amphitheaters to John Wilkes Booth jumping off onto the stage after he shot President Lincoln in the head and giving out some Latin phrase, right? He didn't care if he was identified. He had his plan to escape. They gave him the plan, and they got a patsy in a barn, and they burned him. They burned the phony John Wilkes Booth in a barn, you know, and that's the cover story. They never identified him. That's just like they never identified Hitler, right? He went to South America, but they burned a body. And who was that body? It was double. So Antifa was on the buildings in Germany. Now we got Antifa today, funded by who? Funded
George Soros.
George Soros, who admitted on a documentary that when the roundup was occurring in Nazi Germany or all of Eastern Europe, that he was a finger pointer, and he was a Jew, but he was pointing his finger at all the other Jews in his community, and they rounded him up. Not him, but the others. And they put him into the work programs. They weren't annihilating the Jews that they rounded up. They were not annihilating them, as they said, in gas chambers, and that's been proven out. Okay, that's been proven out. What they were needing them for is slave labor, and then those who were dying, starving to death because they weren't feeding them, then they would burn their bodies for sanitary reasons. Then there were so many they couldn't burn them anymore, and they started burying them in pits. But that then created a good cover story that, you know, that all it was an extermination program. No, when you look at all the underground bases and all the things that they were building, rockets, airplanes, you know, automobiles, you know, for the war, you know, there was a major industrial production. And so why would you kill your slaves? You feed them and you put them to work, you know, and that's what they did. And so so just like they then had this great industrial revolution going on in Germany, right? Setting up the stage for World War II. Oh, and by the way, in 1930s, the military elite go to Tibet, at above Delhi, India, into the top of the mountains, the gatekeepers, the priesthood in Tibet, and they told them, "You are our Aryan brothers, and we were told that we're supposed to give you the secret technology of anti-gravity and of the turbine engines." And so they that's where they come back with this secret technology and started flying anti-gravity Vimanas, and which were being flown in India for thousands of years. You know, they never not had them. Alexander the Great said that they helped him to conquer the Phoenicians in the island of Tyre, because the anti-gravity craft blew up the wall so they could get over it. And even Christopher Columbus, which is his front name, said that he saw anti-gravity craft come out of the waters. They were following him as he was doing the phony discovery of America. So there's all of this evidence of the anti-gravity Vimanas throughout history. Why would they not have them? If they had them at the beginning, why would they not have them now? They do. And as Wernher von Braun, former SS stormtrooper, mass murderer, wanted to become a good family man, decided on his deathbed, to confess that the last ace card they would be using in their grand deception would be a fake alien invasion. Thank you. And so that's where we're at today. It's all a stage. It's all a front, and we've got to see it that way, ladies and gentlemen. So the front that they created in America, you know, just like they had the Kaiser, right, in Germany. No longer we're going to have a Kaiser. Now we're going to have a politician, right? A fascist politician, like Mussolini. He's the best example of one. Boy, that arrogant smirk on his face, you know, and he got his up and comings by the end of the war. But I'll tell you what, let's make this a cliffhanger and let's go to a break. Let's do either one of the graphics at the end, or because we did two books in a row. Normally I want to do this, the quotes and then one of the books and then one of the variety of graphics. I got the last two have variety graphics. Jesse, we're just ramping up and getting a rhythm down, but you know, I didn't want them to see too many back to back in my quotes. It might be anyway, we're there, And we're gonna. Thank you very much. That's the sound. Don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, it's what they didn't want you to know that we're telling right here. So do tell her. After all, you wanted to know, didn't you? Go tell a friend. And if you don't get it live, just realize you got the replay. We'll be right back. Thanks to Jesse Hall and all of you. Just wish my head would stop spinning. Well, that's not me. That's the merry-go-round. Back, Jesse, and I should have said you're tuned in right here to the Forbidden History Chronicles, and we couldn't have done it without Jesse Hall. Jesse, do you have another broadcast? You've got stuff coming up. You want to share that with the friends?
This week we've got the Missing Link, and we've got some really exciting people coming up We have Kevin Annette. He's the one that's served the Queen with an arrest warrant. And so that's on Tuesday.
Yeah, and I just want to add, he was a real advocate for the Native peoples. The story with Kevin Annette, I've interviewed him a couple times. But he was a like an Anglican priest, right? And so he's coming up to the, you know, to Vancouver area, and he's going to work in one of those churches. And then he's visiting the Native peoples, right? And he's finding out how they've been abused by, you know, the Catholic Church and the Episcopal churches and all that. And so Kevin is, you know, just an honest Christian, and he wants to, you know, be, you know, a good neighbor. And in the process of helping people get married or, you know, or have babies or whatever, he's finding out that these people have been persecuted. And so at one point he cuts connection with the, you know, the Vatican related Protestant churches, you know. And so that's, he had a big wake up. He experienced it firsthand. That was his wake up.
Yeah, so that's an exciting interview on Tuesday, November 16th at 8 p.m. Eastern. And then on Wednesday, the 17th, we've got Sasha Stone at 4 p.m. Eastern. And then we've got Max Egan at 7 p.m. Eastern. So another two big names there. And then on Thursday, the 18th, we got Joe Workus at 6 p.m. Eastern. Ty Nefeli from 8 p.m. Eastern. And then Bill Bunting at 10 p.m. Eastern. So we've got six Missing Links interviews coming up this next week that I hope you can all check out.
Outstanding, Jesse. You're going to be a busy guy. I hadn't been getting any notices. Have you been just like taking a break? Because I haven't seen any notices for a couple of weeks, it seemed like.
No, we got our Missing Link YouTube channel deleted, so we're on a new Missing Link YouTube channel. We just started our last four interviews on it. So
that explains it. Yeah, because there's been the disrupt. Okay.
Yeah, so I guess great. I'll have to send you the link for the new YouTube channel.
Okay. Yeah, very good. Thank you. And so I see we got a winding down here for a 3-hour program. So let me see how fast I can get going on this. We're getting close. We got Germany building, ramping up its big machine, right? So they got to make prep over here. They know that World War II is coming, and so they're laying all the groundwork in the different nations, right? With Japan, well, and so we get this guy who is sort of like a high school dropout. He's left home at age 13. He's got no talent. He's never worked construction, not an engineer, not an architect, nothing like that. And yet, all of a sudden, they want to get a guy to build a Hoover Dam. You know, the Hoover Dam would be a very strategic building project. And in fact, during World War II, they actually had gun turrets in the sides of the mountain just in case they got, right? They were prepared for the war. And so anyway, this guy that got the contract to build the Hoover Dam, you know, one of the most technically difficult construction projects in the history of the planet. You know, I mean, Hoover Dam, come on. And so they find this guy who's like a high school dropout, has no background in engineering or architecture or construction, and he gets the contract for building Hoover Dam. What do you think the guy's name is? Jesse, do you know?
No, I'm not sure, but I have an idea that it might be, you know, Jewish related.
How about his name is Kaiser?
Oh, Kaiser.
Right? German, his name is Kaiser. And so he's a front man, you see. Obviously, he couldn't have been building the Hoover Dam. They used the military, you know, what do they call them? The army engineers, right? They used the military.
The DARPA.
Yeah. Yeah, they were planned. They were able to build, right? With all the skill they had. Sure, they laid all the groundwork. They had all the blueprints, all the plans, good to go. And they just, before they break ground, they've got to get the guy that's the front man, and that's Kaiser, right? And so then World War II comes, right? And so they say, what are we going to do? Well, you know, because they're sinking all the ships, like in one three month period, they sank 1,000 ships. Going from America over to Britain, you know, to resupply, you know, the front over there when World War II is starting. And so they're saying we gotta build more merchant ships, and you know, we gotta start building some defensive capabilities, you know. And so they said, what are we going to do? Well, let's get Kaiser. Sure, you know, if he's never built anything before, surely he can build, the ships that we need. And so they say he's got this great idea how you you can build a ship in three different sections. And then you bring the sections together and boom, you can mass produce them. And then they say, well, yeah, but before we can build the ships, we got to build the shipyards. Okay, well, let's do it. We got to build it quick, though. We've got a war going on. Sure. You know, so they go to work and they build these shipyards in San Francisco like in 3 or 4 months. Can you imagine, Jesse, the backing, the smart guy, Kaiser, can do this so quickly, you know? And then after he builds the shipyards, then he's going to build all these ships, and he does such a good job. They say, look, we need to get you to build some submarines. Kaiser can do it, you know? Are you getting it? Isn't it just sounds so – I'm really having fun with it. You can tell, right? I mean –
sounds like Kaiser Soze.
Yeah. Not only that, but then when they get all the workers at the shipyards, he, of course, this will be a natural evolution of all that. He creates an insurance company, Jesse, and he gives them all the workers on the shipyards free health insurance, you know, right? And so he even got an insurance company out of the deal, Kaiser Insurance, you know? And so it's amazing, you know, the game. Because, you know, we all just yum, meet it up. Man, it sounded good to me. I don't know. But, yeah. And so now we've got German secret bases right in Russia. Then we got the flags. Remember, we showed the rising sun right on the flags. They were the let's see if I can find them real quick here. All right. Go on up elevator. Because you got to read symbols. Signs and symbols rule the world, not words nor law. So here are all the symbols of the rising sun. After World War II, then the German flag becomes the rising sun. Here's the darkness. Here's the red sunrise and the bright sun at high noon. You know, same with the flag here in India, you know, rising sun. And then we get, the sun symbols. Here's our sun symbols again, right? All Star David, the swastika, sun symbols, just can't get away from them. A is the symbol of the sun, and then that's why we got the A in front of all these words. And I was looking for another picture, but that was good enough. Yeah, that was it, the rising sun, right hand, left hand. So they had two fronts, right? Remember, divide and conquer, the north and the south, the east and the west, right? So we got the Japanese with the rising sun, and then the German with the rising sun. See, so we got the East, right? And then we got the West. And so we got the war on two fronts. And, oh, what's interesting, of course, with World War II, right, is I call Japan Jupan, right? It's rather interesting play because, number one, remember, the letter J did not exist, right? So let's look at this for a second here. We got Japan. Let's go down. But it's a word game because there is no J, and so it's like that. You see, because there with a P, there's always an H, always. They just corrupted them, you know. So it's the Jupan, but pan is fan, and so like Pangea, you know, means everywhere, the pan on the pan. So the fan is the full thought again. It's that swastika that's going around. So literally in the word fan, you got the swastika. Okay? That's the fan. That's the thing that's going around, right? Thing that's going around. And that's the fan. And so you got Yafan, but it's the Jew fan. And then so Hirohito, the emperor, was the only emperor or leader in history that was also into biological weapons. He was a scientist, okay? But what's interesting, get this, right? He's waging war against mankind. He's waging war against the other nations, right? And he's going to attack Pearl Harbor, America. And guess what? He attacks them. But the one thing, the most important thing you could ever do to take down your enemy would be to take down his fuel supply. And so what the American Roosevelt did, because he knew they were going to attack because he's Illuminati, and that's how the game was going to be played, they got all the ships that they didn't want into the Pearl Harbor, and they got out, took out all of the aircraft carriers and anything, you know, that they wanted, and then they let him bomb all those ships in the harbor and kill about 3,000 Navy and Marine soldiers. But in their Torah, they never bombed the fuel supply. All they had to do was blow up the fuel supply on the island, and they would have shut down the entire American Navy. You see? And so it's about, again, knowing the strategic capabilities of what, you know, you have to do in order when you fight a battle, and look at all the pieces of the puzzle. So, in fact, even in the newspaper, the Hilo newspaper, the weekend before they were attacked, in the very newspaper, it said, "Will Pearl Harbor be bombed by Japan?" You know, my friend Ralph Epperson got a copy of the microfiche, and he, you know, he would always share it with people. So, yeah, so they knew, and but he didn't take down the oil reserves, so somebody was stupid. And so today's war, World War II, rounded up all the peasant Jews with George Soros at the head. And so interesting that Soros is this word, S-O-R-O-S. Oh, it's a power name, right? The zero, and there's where you get the word as well. All the power names. So he's the power broker. He's giving away billions of dollars, you know, not blinking an eye, because he's an insider. There's no money anyway, right? It's all a shell game. So what happened? Bottom line, with World War II, when it was all said and done, what happened to Germany? Oh, it's divided. You know, that divide and conquer again, that right hand, left hand, like the northern Assyrians and the southern Assyrians, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, the north and the south, right? Always dividing, because they got to control, make sure they can maintain control on both sides, and they got each other thinking we're the enemy when they're the enemy. So Germany is divided, and you got East Germany, which is the extreme behind the Iron Curtain mind control experiment called Eastern Germany, run by the Khazar Jews, who hate everybody's guts, and they did the ultimate psyops on those poor people over there, those good German people that were innocent, right? Because there's the innocent. And they don't have an agenda, and then you got those on the agenda. So that's World War II, ladies and gentlemen. So, but now we got to get to today. What about today? What's the war? What's the game that's being waged on us? Because it's very serious. We got people suffering today. Even apparently, with what's going around, it seems like that our friends that we care about are actually. I have a friend in Cleveland that just died in the hospital. They put the pipe down her throat and did everything to kill her. And they did. She texted me from the hospital and says, "Desert, you're a good guy." I said, "Who's this?" And she said, "This is Susan. I'm in the hospital and they're treating me." And she didn't last but a week. So the war is, so now the war, the home front is your doorstep, ladies and gentlemen. The war is at your doorstep. I'm trying to figure out what card to go through first here. You know, we hear about these agencies called the IRS, the FBI, BATF. They sound, you know, and then there's the Homeland Insecurity and all that. You know, they're all agents of the banking. They're not a part of the American institutions. That is a front and a facade and a stage anyway, right? But the IRS, FBI, BATF, all of them working for the Federal Reserve Bank. Okay, and you know, like the FBI in last century, in the 1990s, when I was a political activist, and they were going like into other police stations or into you know, fire stations, and they were talking to the police and to the firemen, and they said and they're brainwashing them in their meetings, and they're saying, you know, these Christians and these homeschoolers, they're terrorists, you know. So they were calling, the FBI was calling Christians and homeschoolers terrorists back last century. Okay, so put two and two together, and you're the enemy. Remember, War and Emergency Powers Act 1933, You were declared the enemy by the banksters. You were declared the enemy. War Emergency Powers Act. Jews tracking down Nazis. Yeah, so since they control Hollywood documentaries and movies, so we constantly see on YouTube and on, you know, on these commercials, Nazi hunters. You know, the Jews are going after Nazis. Isn't that the best cover there ever could be? The Nazis are going after the Nazis. Ladies and gentlemen, put two and two together. Stop being the fuel for stupidity and fodder for their game. You know, and tell your friends. That's the idea. You know, this broadcast is going to a microcosm of just a few people, but this is something that everyone would want to know. So they are the Nazis, and they are the authors of hatred, because they hate your guts, and they say so in their Babylonian Talmud. They say that it's okay to rape children in the Babylonian Talmud. Great lies. What is this? Pandemic fraud. Yeah. The charts double every day, 3.5. I can't even remember what that note is. And the DC, therefore, is nothing but a prop. And the word capital means capital. That means head count. Kappa for head, tail for tally. Head count. That's all it is. It's about managing slaves. Slave. And they took over our Bible. And that's where we'll pick it up on that part in the next program. We're going to talk about, I'm going to show you their signature and their hallmarks in our scriptures. And we're almost at the end here. I've got Australia as per today, okay, because they're on the front line today. And they talked about the name of the concentration camps there. And I heard it on one of the broadcasts. And they called it Nikolon. And Nikolon, I guess I should have gone to the words. Let me do that. Okay, so Nikolon. Spelled like this. Two words. And immediately I saw the code. All right, because Nick means secret. And so it's the secret to kill is the secret to kill. Because you see the word Kel in there, you see this word. You see it's an overlay. Two words. You got Kel, which is originally like Celtic, which means killing technology. That's what Celtic meant. And then you got Nick overlaid here for secret. And then you got L for the illuminated to know the code. And then it's on, right? So we know that means the switch is on. So Nikolon literally means in the code, the secret to kill is on. That's your concentration camp. That's why those politicians are lying. Lying, and the news media are lying, because it's game up, game over, ladies and gentlemen, because the chips are in, because the planet is going down. They destroyed our world, the oceans. The oceans are dying. Dane Wigginton talks about Canfield effect, that there's dead zones in the oceans today. All the starfish died off the coast of California. All the dolphins and the whales have beached themselves. You know, it's terrible. The ocean of San Diego is 20 degrees above normal. That's a death zone for fish and for the sea life. Let me read you a quote. When I used to come on broadcasting in last century, I used to, about in the mid-1990s, 1994, 1995, 96, I would bring on Bev Collins from Canada with the Canadian Institute for Political Integrity and Ian Murphy of the Aussie Freedom Scouts in Australia. He was friends of Brigadier General Sarong of the World War II. He was sort of like our General MacArthur. You know, he's a war hero, and they all knew. You know, they knew what was coming, and they tried to tell everybody, don't give up your guns. You know, and that was right at the time when then they told everybody in Australia to hand in your guns. We'll give you money. We'll buy your guns from you. We'll give you drugs, whatever you want. Just give us your guns. And it was all to set them up for what was coming. As we learned, like right above Australia, East Timor, the United Nations were there. They tell them to give up their guns. Then they kill 250,000 people on the island of East Timor right above Australia back around 1995. And nobody talked about it except a good journalist out of Australia, actually. I can't remember his name at the moment, but he's real maverick. And so so I wanted to read this from Ian. You know, he had a stroke last century and died probably around 1998 or 99, just before the New Deal swept in. And let me just take a sip of my drink here. I want to thank everyone for staying with us today, if you hung out.
We just got a comment from Queen Kinois Desiree says, thank you. Glad to be here listening.
You know, it's really not easy to do this, Jesse, I got to tell you. I wanted to cancel the program last couple days. You know, I said, I just don't know if I can do this. This is not, you know, I prefer to do the scriptures, you know, and the lost writings and the translations and stuff. And it's so hard to do this. Who wants to talk about this, you know? Who wants to make this their mission in life, to have to explain how these creeps are raping babies and murdering, you know, your grandparents, you know, and everybody in between? Who in the world in their right mind would want to make this their you know, their life work? And my life was always on a unique path. You know, I was an owl too, and I could see them because I studied ancient history. And I studied the symbolism of the ancient past and the word problems, you know, with the different, you know, Aramaic and Hebrew and all the Sanskrit and everything in between. You know, I was already a conscious thinking creature in the ancient past. And then when I found out, when I got stuck in a truck in an 18-wheeler, you know, and found out that these people were psychopaths, you know, and I heard people that came on the radio telling stuff and spilling the beans, and then I said, well, something's going on. So I, as a researcher, it took me a year to figure it out. But I realized I had to get involved, you know, because I knew that this was real and they were coming for all of us. And you know, I had a daughter at the time, you know, that I wanted to fight for her freedom. And so I rolled my sleeves up and got involved as a political activist from a spiritual pacifist. And then I learned the rest of the story, you know, the rest of the truth. That, you know, this is not our world. That's the good news. This is not our planet. We're here to have an experience and to wake up to the true nature of the beast. The beast system is the government system. And the serpent is the flesh, because the flesh can never be satisfied. It craves more and more and more. So we have two natures. We have one of a lower serpent, and then we have a spirit that's within. And we have to identify with the spirit and realize that we transcend this world. That the one they chose, the darkness, let them have it. You know, it's not to say that I don't wish the good guys could win, but look at how stacked against us it is. That they control it all: the media, the internet, the medicine. You know, they control everything. There's nothing that they don't control, and so that's why they kill off all the good people. They got their phones tapped. They took all the good green berets, put them on a jet last century on an airplane, you know, a military plane, and in Newfoundland, Canada. And they, as soon as it took off, it came back down and crashed. They killed all the good people when they were getting the green beret to do assassinations of different political activists, you know, around the world. They thought they were killing the bad guys, and they finally found out they were being told to kill the good guys. That's how they do it. That's why 6 years ago, when they killed off like 20, over 20 naturopath chiropractic doctors and some medical doctors.
200 right? of them.
Well, that, you know, that added up. After a couple of years, it ended up to be 200. But it started out in the first year, the count was just in the 20s, and then it kept going up. And then my all-time classic interview. My best interview I ever had by Dr. Lorraine Hurley out of New England, you know, back 6 years ago when I first came here to Millersburg and got stuck here. She gave me a full week of interviews because she couldn't pin me down and said, we'll have to do a full week. And she gave me the best interviews I ever had. And then she became a friend. And within about 6 weeks, she was riding her bicycle out there somewhere. And she was totally against putting anything up your nose. She said, you don't put anything up your nose, you know, to touch the brain barrier. you know? And so she was no different. She quit being a medical doctor. She already quit. She didn't want the money. She was an advocate. She had her own radio program. She interviewed me. And so 6 weeks after she did my classic interview, she was run over. They killed her. They ran her over. And so it was just 3 or 4 months ago when I finally realized why they killed all those naturopathic, chiropractic, and medical doctors that were good advocates. And it was because of what they're doing right now. They had to kill them because they would have been the best advocates of truth against what's going down right now. You right, Jesse?
100%.
Yeah, that's why they had to kill them. We didn't know why. We just thought maybe because they were exposing something about Nogales or, you know, something else. But it was because they would have been a team to fight against, you know. And so they got rid of them. Use their little Ashkenazis and their little Ashkenazi pistols. So anyway, so this is what Ian Murphy wrote and said. May he rest in peace. He had a 300,000 acre ranch out there and somewhere in the Nicarbo Station in the boondocks, and you know, they had cattle and stuff there, and these ranchers were the smartest people because they know what's going on when they're being played for a fool. These are the smartest people because they live on the land and they think for themselves, you know. So he said, Australia, beware. Let me blow it up a little more in case somebody wants to read this. Follow along. Okay. Australia, beware. Oh, Australia, great South continent, your red heart burns on fire as you face your test of greatness in the times we know so dire. Australian sons and daughters, before you now I stand to warn you of the danger that threatens our great land. Our vast shores undefended lie prey to foreign foe. While governments disarm the people, we all must tell them no. Our bishops are all silent on the issues of ethics grave. Oh, Lord, where is their conscience for those they've been bound to save? Our nation is plagued by treason in high places, high and low. Our leaders wash hands like Pilate and condemn our land to die. Behold now, Hawke and Keating, those men of Judas shame, who do they think they're fooling? All Aussies know their game. We've watched them trip to Moscow. Oh, just like Bill and Hillary Clinton, just like Ho Chi Minh, just like other Australian presidents, just like the presidents from other parts of the world. They all go to Moscow where they celebrate communism on Red Square, where the double-headed eagle is, a Freemasonry, and get their further marching orders. Then they go back and run their puppet countries under the imagination of imaginations. We've watched them trip to Moscow to get their orders true and come back to control us. Be sure they will get their due. Let's kid ourselves no longer that she will be all right, mate, but wake up to that threat now before it's all too late. Let's honor all of our warriors who died on foreign shores to save our precious loved ones from this awful cannon's roar. Let's revive the Anzac spirit as in cries now long past, and throw down now the gauntlet and show them we'll hold fast. So Aussies, make your plans now to protect our land and folk, so our children will have freedom and be spared the tyrant's yoke. So let's all pledge our courage as we did in days gone by, and trust in God Almighty, Australia will not die. Ian Murphy, circa 1990, Aussie Freedom Scouts, Australia's bona fide militia, along with Brigadier Sarong, World War II veteran. Rest in peace, dear brother. And yeah, ladies and gentlemen, the truth is stranger than fiction. We got evil people running our world. They hate our guts. I have a few more notes. Let me just see what I got here. So if you know, to show these people, we have a Hebrew lexicon. And when you look in the Strong's Hebrew lexicon, it's called the Hebrew Chaldee. You see, why do they got Chaldee attached to it? Because Chaldee means Babylon. So it's the Hebrew Babylon concordance. You see, they're telling you, but we can't interpret the word. Just like right here, I got a lexicon, right? It's called Jacinius's Hebrew Chaldee lexicon. But let's look at this word, lexicon. Let's look at it. Okay, we're at the end here. I will stay on with questions if we have any from Jesse or for anyone out there. I can hang out a little bit unless Jesse's got to go. But I just don't want to wind down with my last few notes. So let's look at this.
Just to let anybody know, if you do have any questions about anything that, you know, Desert has mentioned here or, you know, brought up, now's a good time to type it. So as he gets through, because it takes a little bit of time for you to type your questions so you don't miss out. If you do have any questions, would be a good time now to start putting them into your into the chat box.
Yeah. In fact, when we talked about that mother earlier, I just saw this. It flashed when I did the wrong letter. Jesse, look at this. You know what that's a symbol of? Not just mother. What else? Freemasonic apron.
Oh, the Mason.
Right? Gmail, right? When you open your Gmail, you always see the symbol, right? The mother. Mm-hmm. There it is. See? So let's look at this. So Lex is Latin. Lex is Latin. They call it the Jacinius' lexicon, right? And this is how it's in our face, how they've corrupted all of our words. Just like I say, dictionary, you know, it should be a lectionary, right? The D is the dead letter, right? But Webster didn't know. It's okay because Webster still told the truth. But let's look at this. Lex is law. And then, you know, so we see the I, so it looks like this, right? But the implication is of, okay? The, what do you think the last word is, Jesse? Con. Law of the con. A lexicon is the law of the con. You see, it's in our face. And we can't read. We cannot read. And so, okay, so I've been paying attention. You know how they just did a stunt in Houston at the Astro Theater in Houston and with the people dropping dead right at the concert of this.
The Travis Scott concert and the Afro World concert.
Yeah, because we're talking about the World War III, which is happening right now. We're in World War III. So I think it was earlier today I was watching Max Egan. I mean, he may have mentioned it there. I don't remember where I wrote this note now. But there's a rock band that's all out of England, and they're called Kaiser Chiefs. You see? And what they're telling everybody is you don't come to the concert unless you get, you know what, right, in your arm. And so
the demon juice.
Yeah, that's right. So they're called Kaiser Chiefs, right? And so while all these rock bands pretended, you know, like Led Zeppelin, right? Remember they did the song, and she's buying the stairway to heaven, right? Who's buying the stairway? The occult. They're buying our way back so that we cannot follow the trail because they've corrupted everything. We can't read. They say, go spell, right? In the gospel, when it should be in the Greek, it should have been evangelion, which means the star message of enlightenment. But instead they put gospel there for you to go spell. Fool, because you cannot spell. Just like, let's look at this word here. One got another one. Okay, almost done. But this one is too important not to do, to cap this off here. So D-E-M-O, D-E-M-O-C-R-A-C-Y. Okay, let's look at this word. Okay, because everybody's using it. It's like a mantra, right? Oh, we got to have democracy. Let's get democracy back. Come on. Democracy, democracy, democracy. Wait a minute. In the Greek, it's D-E-M-O-S-C-R-E-A-T-O. And I learned this in sixth grade. By the way, I never forgot. I actually learned something in school. And when they told me the meaning of democracy, I never forgot it, that it was demo creatos. And then later on, when I, you know, got into the word etymologies, it was not hard to transliterate that. It is. Do we really want that? I think the answer is no, right?
No.
You still there, Jesse?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. Yeah.
Fox
so
just made a visit.
So it says that so just like the Rothschild Jews are the defenders and protectors of the Vatican Trust, which is all Jewish, all Ashkenazi, all Khazarian. The Masons. I read the slogan one day that the Masons are the perpetrators of the democracy, of the demon creation. So you see, so it's just fitting another piece of that puzzle, right? That's what it is. And so Johan, I loved your quote about what did you call Facebook? You called it Meta.
Meta Facebook.
Meta Facebook. I loved that last night when I saw that. Sure. So way to go, Jesse. I shared that with Ninja. So Facebook is now Meta. And so what does Meta mean? Okay. M-E-T-A. It means beyond. So I guess it means that we're going now to the great beyond, Jesse, because they've changed the name of our faces, right? The great beyond. So so there it is, ladies and gentlemen. You just got the forbidden history, and it's not pretty. Floor is open, Jesse.
Okay, well, I didn't see any questions on here, so thank you very much for everybody, you know, here with your comments, your shares, you know, your likes, subscribe to our channel here. We've got our new YouTube channel as well as our new Missing Link channel. Just trying to get you the best information that we can so we can understand what's happening, you know, through all these insane times. So maybe if we kind of know what's going on and enough people wake up, maybe we can actually do something about it. So thank you very much to the Desert for coming here, you know, and sharing his information with us. You know, he takes a lot to put these presentations together. So we really appreciate that, you know, you take your time out to help, you know, educate people in this time that, you know, we need education more than, you know, through any time in history. So thank you, Desert, for all that you do.
Well, thank you, Jesse. You're part of that. You know, couldn't have done this without you. And did you see my note on the original Vincent song?
We can do. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So that's the closing music at the top there?
Yeah, with the words, because since we're on YouTube right now, until we get back on Facebook, we can use it with the words. So I sent you that link for that. And so with that, I just want to tell everyone, don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to know the future, then you need to look for the Forbidden History, because it's all right here, coming your way every Sunday at 12 noon Eastern time. And it's what they didn't want you to know, of course, that we tell right here. It's the Forbidden History Chronicles. Do tell a friend, and we'll look for you next Sunday. Father willing, we'll be back. Thank you.
God Jesus. Bless. God bless you all.
Starry, starry night. Paint your palette blue and gray. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills. Sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chills in colors on the snowy linen land. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, how you suffered for your sanity, how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night. Flaming flowers that brightly blaze. Swirling clouds in violet haze reflect in Vincent's eyes of china blue. Colors changing hue. Morning fields of amber grain. Weathered faces lined. Are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen. For they could not love you, but still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, you took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful as you. Starry, starry night, portraits hung in empty halls, frameless heads on nameless walls, with eyes that watch the world and can't forget, like the strangers that you've met. The ragged men in ragged clothes, a silver thorn, a bloody rose, lie crushed and broken on the virgin snow. Now I think I know what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they're not listening still. Perhaps they never will.
Friends,
commercial time.
You're living in the past.
Why are we waiting another week before we are asking the general public to put a mask on when they go into a shop?
Well, it is of course safe in shops, and
now at an individual level, the chance of anybody watching this dying of coronavirus are actually low. Over the whole epidemic, even if we have no vaccine, a high proportion of people will not get this.
When tyranny becomes law, rebellion becomes duty.
That completes the shipping bulletin. Wishing you a very peaceful night wherever you may be, and a great weekend. Hope you can join us at some point. Good night.